30 seconds a pop max for each. So I don't know. Do you want to do this changes in social policies or just social policies? I kind of wanted to do everything.
I'm fine with anything.
I want to do everything, basically. Starting off with social policies, every single tree, even those ones that are not changed still.
Okay.
And Pantheons, religion, warfare overall, even like game mechanics, we can talk about it a little bit.
All right, I want it manageable though, Yoruus. So I'm all right with kind of general ideas. Let's go through the change log as listed on Fruitstrike's page. Let's go through the social policies.
Okay.
We can do social policies first, then change log, and then we can talk about a couple general ideas from each of us. So if you have stuff you want to add that's not included in that, that's fine. I want to do something like 30 seconds each, and maybe like a rebuttal if we have rebuttal. So a lot of times we're just going to be, and basically what I want you to basically be saying is, fine as it is, needs changing. Is it too strong or too weak, and why, inside of 30 seconds, right? I don't want it to be like 10 minutes each talking, because we'll never get out of here.
Are you in rush somewhere?
Well, I mean, I don't want to do this for 6 hours. three seems reasonable. Six seems a bit long.
I need to go to work in 8, so come on. Don't be a pussy.
30 seconds, Yoruus. Can you be that short?
Of course.
Okay.
Do you have a timing machine or something like that? So you'll check if I'm...
A timing machine? Overboard? Is that what they call them in Poland?
No, I have no idea. How do you call it? Like, give me a second. God damn it.
I feel like Fruitstrike should be moderating.
Okay. All right, cool. I'll moderate. So, oh, Baba's here. Okay. Hi, Baba.
Hello.
Stopwatch. See? Stopwatch.
Okay. So, I was just setting up my stuff on the stream so people can watch the notes and everything. Do you guys want me to, like, go through general ideas of what I was thinking with the trees and stuff and why they are the way they are? Or do you want to, like, talk about that first? Like, I'm fine with anything, really.
Okay. I
would say, yeah, go on.
I have a vision for today, and today it involves lots of, rather than us debating on stream, which will go on endlessly and never have any sort of result, what I want is the opportunity for each person to express their opinion. And that's not necessarily, they might be contrasting opinions, and that's fine. We don't have to resolve that today. I don't need people to come to any sort of resolution.
Cool.
What I want is each player to kind of be like, oh, this is what I think of this policy. Here's why I think it's too strong or too weak or just fine, and then move on, right? And then each person get a chance to do that.
I would say let's do it.
Sounds good.
Do it trees, basically. So, like, let's not stop on the single policy. Let's say,
okay,
starts on tradition, then Baba, then me, then Fruitstrike, and then we go to liberty and so on and so forth. So maybe not like 30 seconds on policy. Let's say
so
6 minutes.
So six 30-second policies is there's six policies in a tree. Six 30-second policies is like 180 seconds, which is 3 minutes a tree, right?
Yeah, something like that.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm fine with that. I don't even have to go over anything about the trees if,
hey, Naku,
if it's not important.
Dude, did you see my post?
Tradition, literally, the only change I made is oligarchy and aristocracy swap, and that's it.
Oh, actually, I would like to talk about tradition a little bit.
Okay.
All right, let's do it like this then.
Go, Yoruus, you're first.
There you go.
I don't know.
Yeah, no, I'm totally fine with that. Let's keep the same order. Go. It can be Yoruus, Bob, and me. That's fine. If Arvius shows up, we'll fit him into the process.
Right. I think when I talk to Baba, by the way, I think Baba's probably just going to be responding to what people say. I think he didn't really. Is that correct, Baba?
I don't have much of an opinion.
You don't have an opinion on playing this at all?
Okay.
You like have any sense of the strength?
Not really.
Baba, really?
Yeah.
You've just gone through the game and been like, there's no relative strength here. At all.
Yeah.
It's not too strong, it's not too weak. So if I would give you 10 settlers, you'd be like, no opinion.
Yeah, Baba just goes with the flow, you know.
Well, to be fair, I'm less concerned with too strong or too weak, because a lot of times that kind of stuff is really easy to change from a balance perspective. I'm more concerned with can do, can't do, meaning like, you know, things that you can do and things you can't do as a result of trees, etc. And
too strong, too weak is why I'm concerned about this, because we're concerned about game balance, okay. Right? That's the stuff that's going to be most interesting. I mean, certainly there's the can and can't is useful to know about, but being able to speak right now, this is supposed to be basically kind of an update of, here's the state of the mod right now, what do we need to see the future direction looking like based on how strong or how weak these things are right now?
Okay.
I'm basically ready. It's turned out that aesthetics and rationalism are the way it is. It's fine with me.
Aesthetics and rationalism are fine with you?
Yeah.
You don't want to talk about them at all?
No, I can talk about a little bit.
All right, Yoruus, why don't you start? Why don't you go left to right on the tree? Are you open? I just have Civ open so I can see all the trees. You want to start with tradition, Yoruus, and do your 3 minutes, then I'll do mine, then Baba can do his. Or if Baba doesn't want to do anything at all, I don't quite know why, but
yeah,
okay.
Sure.
I'll ask Baba questions. I'll be an inquisitor.
All right, let's start with tradition then. Well, first of all, the opener. I would like to say that I would like to add +2 food and capital in addition to +3 culture. And basically the reason for that is it allows for a little bit more boost in the early game for tradition. It's not like a huge boost, but it allows you to get a little bit more hammers into the capital at the start. So I think it's really, really cool to compensate for the other improvements in the other trees. But that's just for the opener. Now, aristocracy and oligarchy as the polis itself, there's nothing to change in there, basically, but I don't like the swap. I don't get the idea about the swap with aristocracy and oligarchy, because basically aristocracy now without any cost, you've got the boost to wonder production at the early game, and I don't feel like that's the right course for tradition. I actually like that oligarchy filler. It's a crappy policy itself. Basically, it's a crappy policy overall, but the point is you got to take it. And you can't take aristocracy now. Aristocracy is just good. So right now, if you go through tradition, you get like opener strong, aristocracy strong, legalism strong, monarchy strong, landed elite strong. And now, okay, I need to finish tradition. Fine, let's pick that goddamn oligarchy, right? And now if you go for the early game, now if you want to rush wonder with tradition, okay, it's an opportunity cost. You got it. Delay the other good policies in tradition because you want to rush a wonder. So there's a cost involved in just going for a wonder rush instead of just, okay, nah, screw it. I got aristocracy anyway, so let's build a wonder. And
okay.
That's one. There's just little things about the tooltips that are missing, but that probably will be finished, right? So like engineer tooltip,
yeah.
Hangaris tooltip, aqueduct tooltip, and all that stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And now the only thing that I would like to add though is like the finisher in tradition, the +15% growth. I strongly feel that it should work like Temple of Artemis and Floating Gardens from Aztecs. It should count to overall food. So not like the excess food that you got that is counted to growth, just the overall food to like Temple of Artemis is working and Floating Gardens is working. I think it's a huge boost right now because like compared to other trees, tradition just does not look that cool at all in here. And just one more little thing, not 4 cities, but I would say 3 cities. Small empire, three cities, cargo, well, 6 caravans, tradition. Like with the amount of slots you have for caravans and all that stuff, basically the best idea is to have 3 very, very strong cities. But to compensate for that 4th city, I would actually add legalism, free walls. You're probably asking why free walls, right? It's quite simple for me because like, first of all, you got to get those settlers up and running. And most of the time you're missing the hammers. Like now Honor has, well, we're going to talk about it later on.
But 10 seconds, yours.
Okay. Yeah. Liberty has hammers. Honor has hammers. So like cranking out those walls to defend against Honor and Liberty, it takes too much time.
Okay.
So add 3 walls, basically. That's my opinion.
Time.
Done.
All right, Bobby, you want to go next or you want me to go next?
Let's go.
No, go ahead, man. If you have something to say, go ahead.
I think tradition is fine, personally.
Is that it?
Yeah.
Yep. All right, I'll go. It's funny, like yours, I come up to very, very different conclusions from a very similar set of information, right? Like, I actually think tradition right now is maybe a little underpowered compared to the other trees out there. From my perspective, I don't think we want to be doing things like nerfing their opening policies. I would actually prefer to see, I like the policies as they are, they're totally fine in my opinion. I think the positioning is a little awkward. I think it would be fine to revert tradition how it was before it was nerfed. That meaning leaving tradition opener as it was, opening with legalism, and then having oligarchy and aristocracy as floater policies. The way it plays out to me right now, tradition seems very wonder-oriented early, which actually aristocracy is quite good for, although I don't necessarily need to open that way. But it feels like to me the other civs are getting huge benefits to production or expansion early, and tradition isn't, and it feels very, very slow to play it. So therefore, I don't actually think that I need to see something like oligarchy be in front of legalism or landed elite or monarchy. I feel like opening tradition and then entering legalism, monarchy, and landed elite is totally fine as it is, or totally fine as it was. The wall thing is very interesting to me. I'm kind of okay with that. I don't care if it's three or four cities, although moving it from four to three is a nerf. And if you think it's a little weak already, it seems strange to continue to nerf it either way. But overall, I think tradition's fairly okay right now, maybe slightly weaker compared to the other policies, but is overall kind of an okay position. And I kind of like how the tenants do, or kind of like what the tenants do overall. I kind of hate oligarchy, that being the exception. It feels like a very weak policy. It's a weak policy that's just kind of thrown in there that you kind of have to do. Maybe that could be the wall policy or something like that. Maybe it could give you free walls and still have the bonus it has or something like that. Because right now, all you do for oligarchy is you take that very last as a finisher for the policy. And it's not fun, right? Like, most of the policies are like, shit, I can't wait for this policy. It's going to do this, that, or the other for me. If you do oligarchy, it does fuck all for you. Other than that, I think tradition's fine as is. Fruitstrike?
Okay. I also have, because in the channel, but he doesn't have a mic, and I told him he could type to me and I would say it out loud for what
Who?
He says. He said, Lek. Lek is here.
Yeah.
Do you see Lek?
I do.
He says he likes tradition better with aristocracy on the side and oligarchy in the middle. Reverting it would be best of all, essentially. Okay, cool. Okay, cool.
Okay, cool.
Did you want to talk about your vision for tradition for your couple minutes for Chai?
Yeah, I don't actually have a vision for tradition. Basically, the thing, because it was always the strongest, like it was always the go-to default pick no matter what. So I was like, okay, well then I leave it alone in general, and then I buff everything else as best I can to be on par with it so that it's an actual choice. But one thing I'll say is I think oligarchy is actually a strong choice when you're on the defense, but most of the time it's a useless choice. And so as a result, oligarchy, I'm not sure if oligarchy should necessarily be changed. Maybe that's where free walls go if we wind up doing something like that, because it makes sense. You know, like if you have defensive units and defensive yeah. strength, the defensive building goes there. I like the idea of reverting it if it's too weak. I'm fine with that. Like reverting the position to legalism being from the opener if it's too weak. That's because I hate the idea of taking a policy that I don't want, period. I just hate a policy that I don't want, right? And so yep. that's why I put oligarchy on the side, because it's like, okay, it's not a policy I want, but I would if I can delay it for the finisher, then essentially that policy is itself and the finisher, so it doesn't feel shitty to take it, right?
Yep.
Well, I gotta add something to this. Like,
yours, just hold on a second. But first, start finish. We're gonna do a rebuttal thing, so yep. you're gonna get a chance
it's
to respond.
Okay. I'm done.
Okay, so let's do. I think 30 seconds of rebuttal is all we can do. So why don't we do that?
Did you do debate in college or something?
No, but I want this to be somewhat timely. So let's give yours 30 seconds to
okay,
respond.
Cool.
Basically, if we swap oligarchy and we add oligarchy to with walls, I kind of like it. It would be very, very strong and helps defense against any other trees that want to rush you with tradition. And about overall, like having what Fruitstrike said, like having the good policies that I want to take, Civ is a game of choices, right? You can't, it would be so diminishing to the game when you have just, you go straight forward. You always
Time.
Have good choices before you.
Bubba?
You don't have to be super duper strict.
I'm
about this.
I am being super. No. We have what, 8 policy trees to get through, plus all of the changes. We're not gonna. I don't want to be here till midnight. So let's
yeah,
you just
lost okay. 10 seconds. Go.
No, it's Baba's turn. Thank you very much. Yours, Baba's turn. Anything else, Baba?
I like Yoruus's suggestions.
So funny.
Lek?
Lek doesn't have anything. He's cool.
Alright, I mean, as I said, I think I don't think tradition needs any more nerfs right now, so the negative portions of what Yoruus is saying I think are not needed. I also like the idea of liking the policies I'm picking, so I like the idea of doing things like reverting tradition to how it was before the nerf from Phyraxis. Alright?
Can I add an overall comment, Mr. Filthy?
We'll do it this once, and then never again.
Okay, then I'm gonna skip it.
Okay.
You're banking your helmet. Okay, cool.
Yoruus, Liberty?
Okay, Liberty, let's go. So, opener. Add plus one science per city. That's one change for me. Republic, fine as it is. Collective rule, settlers in every city, not only in capital. So, boost to production of settlers in every other cities. The reason for that, if I have the time, is basically most of the time you're just gimping yourself, because if you want to go wide, your capital just stays small. And you don't want to do that because capital is the center of the empire. It influences trade routes, gold, and all that stuff. It would be so much beneficial. Get the free city, bam, you plan it, caravan, population four, hammers, and let that second city go crazy on settlers, and the capital just grows to be competitive with other openers. Citizenship, as it is. Representation, as it is, actually it's fine, though I would actually add 50% less culture, not 33, just 50%. And meritocracy is absolutely fine as that, but for the finisher, I would actually add minus 33% to cost of science. Well, basically like the culture, less science required to research text, basically. 33%, I don't know, 25%, but a little bit less. So actually White Empire can be a little bit more competitive in the mid, early, late game than how it is right now. And to add this in the time before we start talking about tradition, I actually have a proposition about tradition, liberty, honor, piety. All of those finishers should be allow buying engineer or great generals with fate starting at industrial era. Even for the cost for like the free person in Liberty. I'm done.
Okay. I'm just taking a couple notes real quick.
Baba?
I can write it down to you and send it to you later.
That's okay. I've been taking notes the whole time.
Tradition is a bit strong. I'm not sure how to fix it.
Even post-patch?
I mean Liberty. Sorry.
Is that it?
Yep.
Do you wish to ever use more than 10 seconds?
Eventually.
He's efficient.
All right. Me or Lek next?
Lek doesn't have anything about Liberty.
All right. Currently, I think Liberty is nicely buffed. I don't think it needs any more beneficial buffs at all, although I really, really like Yoruus' idea about collective rule. I think that's fucking phenomenal. That is a problem, having to build all the settlers when you're building 6 or 7 or 8 settlers out of your capital. It does gimp your capital for a long period of time. So I don't need more science on Liberty. I don't think that's needed. I don't think we need the culture. I'm kind of indifferent to. The culture costs do go up quite heavily, so representation getting a small buff might be fine. Representation tends to be the last policy picked up anyways and tends to be a little bit weaker than all the rest of the policies in the tree, but I really like his suggestion about collective rule. I don't agree with the finisher with the science cost, because to me, Liberty gives up some science for going so wide and in return gets a ton of hammers. And the hammers are almost always used militarily at some point. And it's very scary as a tradition player with a Liberty player surrounding you, expanding and producing units. And I don't think we want to give them also science to be competitive with tradition, because then why the fuck would you ever go tradition if you have better expansion, faster expansion, better hammers, etc. And then you also have equal science early. Liberty seems to do fine for me in the mid to late game with science if it can get that going. It's just there, it tends to have a little bit of a delay where basically you get to crossbows later than tradition, which I think is fine because Liberty has way more hammers than tradition to do it. About purchasing the engineers or great generals with faith, I'm not entirely sure. Nowadays with the mod being as it is, everyone has engineers all the time. People are generating engineers nonstop all game long. You're almost always seeing 1 to 2 engineered wonders off of players before medieval or around medieval, because people build one wonder with great people points and then get workshops, and then it's a very, very quick engineer. I'm not sure I want to see more engineers being part of the game. I like that the competition for wonders being the first of that tech, being the first with the hammers trying to produce things like that. And there's a lot of engineers running around right now. So to give more engineers, I'm not entirely sure that's a good thing. The generals is an interesting point. Great generals are pretty game-breaking one way or the other for pushing into players and defending, so having great generals available is fairly interesting. And one of my, to preempt myself a little bit, one of my complaints with Honor is that the great general policy seems a little bit strong to me. So potentially having great generals available with Faith might do away with that a little bit. Perhaps I could see something like maybe great generals only for that, but I don't think we want to take that away. It's an indirect nerf. Yeah, it's an indirect nerf to tradition as it is that general engineers are so much more prevalent than they are before. I don't necessarily think that we need to nerf tradition again by giving it to everybody else.
Cool. Okay, so Lek was actually saying something, but he didn't type it in time. He says, plus the settlers and engineer purchases minus the science and culture changes. And he says, maybe not engineers. Okay, cool. I've got the rest of my notes from Lek. I don't have to say them out loud, really. So I love the idea of collect rule being every city. That was a change I wanted to make a while ago, but a couple people expressed concerns with it. I don't remember who it was, so I just kind of left it alone, because Liberty was one of the few trees that I didn't have to do major things to make it not completely shitty. But I love that idea. I think it's great. I am also wary of the science change, because that's currently one of the only limiting factors, and I feel like with the science change it's going to become like massive ICS problems that we used to have. Potentially. I mean, I could be wrong. But everything you guys are saying sounds good.
I just want to add one general time. General, just this, saying.
Sure, this is your rebuttal. Go ahead.
This time. Basically, about the science thingy and like traditions, three cities, those propositions. Basically, we're playing on a map most of the time that does not allow more than 4 or 5 cities. Now, if you're opening Liberty and you got to make that choice before you have, scouting information, basically those early social policies you need to pick before you know the most of the land. So now, about that, yeah, it might be a problem when you actually have the space to plant like 10 cities or so, but what if you have spot only for 3 cities? So you choose to go Liberty, you get 3 cities, and you're all going up against, I don't know, Honor guy, Tradition guy on 3 cities as well. You're fucked.
Well, actually, no, because keep in mind, the game mechanics don't work that way. If you have 3 cities, you have the same exact science penalty as they do. So why is that bad?
Yeah, less positive stuff that you have from other trees. This is randomness, right? But what I'm just trying to say that, most of the time, still map decides what you can do. You can pick whatever you want. You can pick tradition, liberty, piety, honor. But in the end, the map most of the time consists of 50% if your decision is correct or not. Because if the map just is not a liberty material or tradition material, in the end, you can't do about that. So just trying to compensate a little bit for that. Maybe I'm wrong, maybe I'm right, I don't know, but I just have that feeling from the perspective that most, like 80% of the games that I do play with the maps basically does not allow more than 4 or 5 decent cities.
Time yours.
So that's just my point.
I'd like to respond just that quickly, which is that I think Fruitstrike, what you could potentially do is slow down the first policy. So if you can change the relative spacing of the policies so that the first policy comes much later than it did before, but the second and third policies come equal to where they were before, you would have more information.
For all trees in general?
Yeah, for all trees in general. So basically, gotcha. That what you do is you get more scouting before the first policy comes out, but your second and third policies aren't delayed. So you get a better decision about when to be making tradition versus liberty, because you have more time to have done the scouting, but your still second and third policies, like your settler policies, aren't going to be any slower than they were now. I don't know if that's possible, because it's not boosting the total cost, it's just boosting the cost of the first one relative to the second and third, which would be really, really awesome. Because then you wouldn't have complaints like, oh man, I wanted to go Liberty here, I had to do that in turn 1. but I had no room, then it would be like, oh, I have a sense of my lands and I can make a decision about what I want to do.
Yeah, another way to accomplish that without changing the actual cost is simply to delay culture ruins until the 16th turn, just like, you know,
that
how
I
faith
like.
Ruins are delayed.
That I like. This one I like, delay culture ruins, yes please.
But it's not just culture ruins, right? The problem is, I mean, not to go out of turn again, but the problem is that you have to make the decision
right.
for liberty after your first scout, which means you're building a monument where, like, so soon, and that's really painful. So if that's delayed a little bit, maybe. Anyways.
Yeah, okay, honor? Cool. They're all possibility. And before we move to honor real quick, I just want to make it clear to people, because, like, you've said this before, Filthy, too. I just want to make it clear to anyone who's watching or listening or whatever. This isn't just deciding to change things based on what a couple of people are saying. This is just suggestions from some people who play the game a lot and stream the game a lot, et cetera, and things like that. And people who are in our TeamSpeak right now, who, like, this is just suggestions and input and data. It doesn't mean that everything on this list is going to happen. It's just, I'm writing it down just so that I don't forget it. So just to be clear with everyone, like, because I mean, as you heard already, like, we've had disagreements between even just the few people on this stream. So you can imagine, you know, trying to do this with hundreds of people is not viable, which is why the subreddit exists. Please feel free to post on the subreddit. Like, I promise you, I read everything. I don't respond to everything because I also have a life, but I do read everything.
Oh, no. How could you have a life?
I know. What? I'm playing Europa? Back to coding, slave! Anyway, okay, so, alright, we can go to honor now.
Alright, honor go then. Opener, perfectly fine with me. Warrior code. I like it. I like it a lot. The only thing that I would actually like to change in warrior code is not two warriors, warrior and an archer. Now, explanation about that. Two warriors seems fine if you want to protect the settlement spot, but it doesn't help you to actually use the opener in honor to farm barbs, right? So if you do not have to protect any settlement spot, which actually going honor is allowing you to do, right, then you want to have an archer, right? So you can actually start farming barb camps without going archery and getting an archer itself. I think it's balanced out, and it's much, much more useful and compensates for the culture in the other trees, basically. So that's idea number one. Professional army. Remove the culture from barracks. Now, the reason about that is because honor kind of... If you open honor, you get the culture from kills. Now, if you add culture to barracks, it's like liberty. So. What's the difference, right? You build barracks, you get culture from barracks, and you have the same output in culture as liberty, because it's like add one culture per city, right? So I don't like that barracks actually give culture. Production is cool, hammers are cool, but I just don't like that one culture. It's not cool. Discipline, fine as it is. Military tradition, fine as it is. Military caste, this one I have the hugest problem with right now. I strongly don't agree with culture from walls and castles, and I strongly disagree with happiness and culture and from walls and castles. I think it's too much. If you get walls and castles on all of your cities, not mentioning like conquer cities, courthouse, honor gives you more happiness than liberty and tradition ever
okay.
can give you. That's just my opinion. I don't know how can I replace that. With
there's
I don't
a
know,
lot
one
things,
happiness
things plus there, yeah.
stuff like that, but I just feel this one is just too huge. Two happiness for walls and two culture, come on. Just honor feels so much stronger than any of the other trees you can change that you can choose from. And finisher. Well, finisher, free general, I'm perfectly fine with that. Science, perfectly fine with that. But experience source, great generals, needs to be removed. You already have a boost to generals by 50 more experience on your units if you finish up honor. Adding
that isn't applied
50%.
Yours. The 50% experience from discipline doesn't apply to honor generation. It never has.
It always have applied?
No, it doesn't apply.
Wait,
all
we
right,
can test
then it should.
That.
Then it should
have...
apply.
Yeah, the
then
tree at Warrior
apply.
Code used to be 50% points to great generals, and I put it in the finisher and doubled it since it was in the finisher. But
that's not what he's saying.
If,
he's talking about discipline. Discipline
well,
doesn't.
Right.
If discipline, well, basically, if discipline does not add to great generals, then yeah, you can add 50% to the general boost. Well, you dropped into me, so give me back my 20 seconds. So if if it does, then you gotta remove the boost to great generals at the finisher. And movement, I totally don't like movement on great generals. This is just too much. You can't counter that in any way, shape, or form if you don't pick honor. So that's just too much. Two movement, four movement generals. No. And still the same change, allow Blank Engineer with Fate and General with Fate as the finisher of Tradition, Liberty, Honor, and Piety Tree.
Done. Yep, I got you. I got that part already.
Baba?
I would agree with everything that Arvius has said.
You mean Yoruus?
Arvius?
Yeah, because he's played Honor a lot. I'd like to hit Heroes
Insight. Oh, okay. You mean just when he plays Honor and says things on his stream, the stuff that he's been saying in general?
Mm-hmm.
Can you summarize what that is?
I mean, like, I want to...
What is Baba's point right now?
His opinion on it.
Why do we fucking have Baba in this conversation if he can't summarize it?
He says that Honor still struggles a lot with all kinds of SimCity-type stuff, and it's strictly because the bonuses that Honor gets... they require farming three camps to keep up, and B, they don't apply to cities individually in general, because, like, you know, anything that you're getting, like, the gold income you get from Warrior Code doesn't get affected by markets or banks or anything. The culture income you get from the opener isn't affected. It doesn't add to border growth of cities, etc. So all the stuff that you get from Honor is... from like killing units and things like that is not affected by any of the modifiers that you would normally get for things that are in cities, stuff like that. And so Honor really needed like a crap load of SimCity stuff. That's what he was saying. And and Lek is saying actually I'm not going to worry about what Lek is saying right now, because I've got his notes in my Steam chat, so I'm good to go with that. I don't need to take up time on the stream with that. So Lek is cool. And although he did say one thing, scaling the free warriors to better units as eras progress, I specifically don't want to do that, because then it incentivizes people to hang on to the warrior code just for cool free units later on. I want it to be an opener tree. I want it to be like the earlier units. Like the warrior archer thing would be a potential fine change if that's the way we want to go, because they're both early units. But I definitely don't want to make it late units. Filthy, you didn't get a chance. I'm sorry. Go ahead, you go.
I'm sorry, I don't mind the order. Alright, for me, I'm fine with the opener. The opener is fine for me. Warrior code is okay. I actually would prefer if it was a bonus attributing as opposed to actual warriors. I don't really care if it's a warrior, an archer, two warriors, whatever it is. I sometimes feel like it's too easy to snowball with military units early to push another player. And if the goal is to try to give Honor some ability to have a SimCity early game by tributing city-states, make it a tributing bonus as opposed to a direct unit bonus. But it's honestly not that big a deal. Warriors are not that big a deal. I really like Professional Army as it is. If you want to remove the culture from it, that's okay. I don't care about the max amount of culture, but Honor struggles extremely much with border expansion. Honor tends to be negative gold for the early game because it has a lot of units. It tends to have negative production because of too many units for the number of cities it has. And it struggles with border expansion. The borders do not fucking expand at all. So if you want to remove culture from barracks, that's fine, but give something back, like borders expand faster for the cities that have barracks in it. That's totally fine for me. I don't care about the culture, but the border expansion is really, really critical to Honor as any sort of cities that actually need border expansion. Discipline's fine as is. I don't care about that at all. I'm like 99% certain that the experience from Discipline, the extra bonus experience that is given to your units, does not apply to Great General production, because I've looked at that before, and it doesn't do that. So I'm pretty sure that isn't a problem. Military Tradition is great as it is. Courthouses are now something that you actually want in your cities. It's a really good way to turn cities around into something useful. I really like it. Military cast, again, totally opposite to yours. I've played a lot of Honor now since Honor's come out. I don't care about the culture one way or the other. Again, I think the culture that Honor gets from farming players or barbs is fine. But the happiness is critical. The three things that Honor really suffers with is gold per turn, order expansion, and happiness. Every Honor game I've played so far, I've pretty much gone rush Notre Dame and prioritized happiness as something that I need to do. Getting city-state allies and stuff like that, and I'm still happiness starved all the time. I can't seem to be happy enough as Honor to have any sort of growth game in it. So I really want to see if military cast has changed. It can't be the happiness element of it. The culture part is okay, but that's, again, if you want to do border expansion instead of culture, so be it. but the happiness is critical to honor. It's already painful enough to have to build castles in my cities just for happiness, but I need the happiness somewhere and I can't get it anywhere else. The finisher, I love the Great General movement. The problem with Great Generals right now is, especially when you're attacking into Great Wall, is that first move crushes them. So you have to move in, and then they get to shoot your guy, and at the start of the turn, if they have first move versus you, they get to shoot your guy again, and it's almost impossible to Great General into people who have first move against you. And four movement points lets you get around that. That's so good for dealing with first move. You can move in with Great General's extra movement and plant them. I also think the overall Great General production is probably too much for Honor. It needs to be toned down a little bit, but I love the movement element of it, and the science element is fine. All right, done.
Okay, cool. I mean, that I already talked about honor. It was like, the whole point of the tree is, I can't make my own empire, so I make one out of my enemies, you know?
Which you have to have happiness to do. Yeah, yours, you get your response. Go ahead, 30 seconds.
Well, the first thing is, actually, Kuba, on your Twitch chat, still, honor shouldn't be a SimCity tree. And that's it.
Okay.
I'm going to respond to that, too. But the thing is, if you're going honor and you have to take the other player's cities, it's a lot of work and effort to do that. If you have no happiness from being able to do that, you can't do that. So if honor is just a perpetual war tree that isn't about taking cities to SimCity at all, it's a failure because you can't win games on like one city in perpetual war. That's going to hurt you, even with the honor, science, gold, and culture. You have to be able to take some land to make it worthwhile. And if you can't afford to take land from happiness, it's not working as intended.
Yep.
Yeah, so
one more
one
response.
Thing I want
to... Sorry.
Yeah, go ahead, Yoruus. Go ahead.
Just balance this out. Four city happiness. Let's assume four cities, right? Walls, castles, four cities, 12 happiness. Tradition, we need 16 pop, right? Capital? What am I saying? 15. 16 pop? Yeah. 15 pop cap. No, more. 24 pop, 12 happiness. 24 pop capital to compensate for that. Liberty, never going to happen. This just doesn't balance out the happiness in the
you
trees.
You get plus one for the 10. So you would need 15 population to balance. Uh-oh, do we lose him?
Lose who?
Hello? Yoruus? Oh, are you there?
I'm here.
Okay. Yeah, because you would get 7 from Monarchy, or not Monarchy, which one is it? Whatever the one is that gives happiness, you'd get 7 from 15 pop, and then you get one more from having 10 plus pop from Aristocracy. To match the 8 happiness you'd get from walls from honor.
And Monarchy is no production to do that, by the way.
Sorry, say that again?
Monarchy is, that happiness is free. It has no production attached to it. Walls are production.
Oh, gotcha. Yeah. Yeah, so I agree that in general, honor SimCity should be worse.
Worse?
No, sorry. I mean, meaning worse than the other trees, because you're getting bonuses to be able to conquer people and stuff like that. But I disagree that it needs to be less than it is now. It just needs to be, maybe it needs to be changed, but it definitely doesn't need to be less than it is now. Maybe just by slight amount, if anything, but I don't think it does, because when you're not at war, you have nothing to do with it, right? Except for farm barbs.
Yep.
Okay.
Fighting?
Fighting.
Oh boy. So okay. I know this is a hotly contested one, so Filthy, let's up it to 45 seconds for piety. How does that sound? Just for piety.
Wait, you mean 3 minutes or 45 seconds?
I don't have that much to say about piety.
Oh,
really.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead, Yoruus.
Basically, just an overall like a note on all the trees. Honor and piety shouldn't be, I don't have the feeling that they should be a viable SimCity, viable SimCity trees that you open, that you want to be competitive versus tradition and liberty. I never felt that.
Okay.
And I feel it's a little bit wrong to try to make them as equally good at SimCity as tradition and liberty, because now you're dumping down the game, basically. It doesn't matter which tree you're going to pick, because there's no cost attached to that. You're just going to pick the tree that's going to give you the most boost to, I don't know, fighting if you want to kill people. And the rest stays the same. Culture, happiness, if you're going to get the same stuff out of it, there's no reason to choose any of the trees, because whichever tree you're going to choose, it's going to be exactly the same. I think it dampens down the game. This is just general opinion about that. So piety, open it, plus to fate. This is I think the most strange thing that I've got to say about piety. The opener, plus two fate. What good does this bring? It's okay, you get the Pantheon, but what then? I'm like, it doesn't help you to achieve the first religion in any way, shape, or form, because most of the time you can't compensate on the Pantheon because you've got no extra food, no extra culture, no nothing. So, like, that's two fate is a little bit diminishing. Shrine and temples, production, yeah, that's okay. That's perfectly fine. And the rest is basically cool. Organized religion, mandate of heaven, perfect, theocracy, perfect, religious tolerance. I like it. I would even add happiness to shrines, because if you get happiness from temples, why people can't be happy with shrines to compensate a little bit on the SimCity ability of piety. And reformation belief, I like it as well. I would even add plus one science from shrines to reformation belief. If it needs to be really competitive, just a little bit with the other trees concerning science and all the other stuff. Finisher, basically the same changes as the rest, which means buying great engineers and generals with fate. Rest, I don't have too much to say. I just have an overall thing to say about piety and religion overall. If we want to make piety a viable opener, you need to put 5, preferably 6 available religions in a game. For 6 players, 6 religions. Because if you open piety and you're going to be fucked up in religion, you're screwed for the rest of the game. So you're going to go piety and you will skip the religion because somebody finds a natural wonder, has like tons of desert or other fate generating pantheons, and will get like, you will not get the religion, you're done, right, with opening piety. So if we want to make piety overall a viable choice at the start anyways, you need to boost 6 religions for a 6 player game. Everybody needs to have a chance to get a religion. And that's it, basically, for me.
Lek, Baba, did you guys have anything?
Lek says it's fine as is.
Baba has nothing? Baba, man, you don't have to be here if you don't want it.
Yeah.
He's too polite. Yeah, if Baba, if you wanna jet, it's totally okay if you want to. I'm also streaming it. If the people who are watching your stream want to at least watch for this part and then come back to your stream afterwards, I'm it's fine, whatever.
Okay.
Bubba's being fucking useless today. It's
okay.
Actually irritating.
All right,
me.
Filthy, you wanna talk?
Yeah. I hate piety as it exists right now. Everything about it is wrong for an opening policy. I like the idea of 4 competitive opening policies. I disagree highly with Yoruus' thought that having 4 openers detracts from the game. I think it adds to the game. It adds options. It's not that all options leave you to the exact same position. It's that all options are viable. They lead you to different positions, but those positions are competitive with each other, and I really like that idea. Piety currently isn't that way. Both honor, liberty, and tradition, all of them right now you can open and have successful games. You open them as a primary policy, the policy you dump your points into, and start from the beginning and do that. You can't do that with piety. What I hate about piety right now in particular is the starting policy. I hate the 2 faith per turn in the capital. I hate this because if you open this policy, you are guaranteed, if there are no other piety players, you're pretty much guaranteed 1st pantheon. There's no more religion from city-states, so this doesn't put any randomness to this. It's just whoever opens piety first gets the 1st pantheon. This is a disproportionately valuable advantage that people don't realize, which is that as every time someone picks a pantheon, the cost for more pantheons goes up. So if you get pantheon first, and you get 2 faith from that pantheon, and then the pantheon itself gives you faith, like even just as little as 1 or 2 faith per turn, you have something like 10 or 20 turns compared to some players where you're generating faith and they're not. This almost always guarantees first religion. I don't think you should be guaranteed first religion by opening a policy point ever. Additionally, I don't like Stonehenge
May
in this
I break
either.
In
no.
In your...
Nope. After.
Hold on, yours. Just hold on 1 second. Just write it down real quick. And then...
I don't like Stonehenge in this policy either. I like there being multiple options to get to a religion, multiple different ways people can go there. And I don't think piety allows that by having Stonehenge tied to piety. An example before this would be if someone was Liberty and needed to get a religion to help out with their Liberty build, they could rush Stonehenge and do that. And they can't do that now without opening piety. The rest of the tree is fairly ick for SimCity. It doesn't offer production bonuses. It doesn't offer happiness bonuses until later. It doesn't offer growth bonuses at all. You're going to fix that with reformation beliefs, you said, and that's fine. But as it stands right now, it's really hard to use this tree as a primary opening policy. Shit, there's something else I wanted to say about this. I don't think there should be six religions in the game in a six-way free-for-all. The whole point of limited resources is that there's competition over the stuff that's in there. If you now say everyone can have a religion, yes, the policies are different strengths, and of course there's going to be who gets first religion is in a better position than last religion, but it's much different than that before. There's a huge amount of diplomacy, a huge amount of gameplay that goes along with accepting hostile religions because you didn't get a religion, but you want the benefits of having some kind of religion. I don't want that removed from the game. I think it adds a lot to it. I think Piety, the opener in Piety, should do something like buff pantheons. That means when you get your pantheon can be stronger. Either it gives you more faith per turn, or something like it only buffs non-faith generating pantheons, so that when you get a pantheon, that pantheon can be your growth in production that other trees don't give you, or other trees give you but Piety doesn't, and then it also gives you some religion to do something with that, and that would be great. I like that kind of buff. I don't like a buff that just says straight up, if I pick this policy, I get a religion and I probably get first or second. If you've been in a game with three or four people opening one point in Piety, you don't get a religion because it's that big of a deal, the two faith independent of a pantheon.
Okay. What did you want to say, Yoruus?
Last game with you, Mr. Filthy, and actually breaks your terror crafting in here. I have a huge feeling, and it's always have been like that, that religion, nothing can guarantee you first religion on a free-for-all map with wonders, because you always are able to lose to a guy who finds a natural wonder, or perhaps get a pantheon with plus four faith from wonders. Piety does not guarantee you religion. Best example, last game with us, I opened Piety, I got Stonehenge, I got 3 extra fate from my pantheon, so that's 10 fate a turn, on turn, what, 20-something-ish? No religion, no first religion, no Seri.
I get to respond to that, so let's respond to that. I think currently, we haven't got to the pantheons yet, but one of the pantheons right now is too powerful relative to the others, and that is the God of War pantheon. And that's what I had that game.
Okay.
You were one turn behind me on the founding religion, yours, and you were one turn behind me on enhancing the religion. And I got there ahead of you only because of God of War giving me huge amounts of faith from farming barbs. And it gives me way too much. I had 2 natural wonders and I still didn't pick up 4 faith from natural wonders because God of War gives me more than I need already. So I hear your point, yours, but I don't agree.
So God of War, in order to make it an attractive purchase, it used to be 50% faith from kills within 4 tiles. I made it 100% faith from kills within 6 tiles. And added a little boost to the barracks as well. But that's really easy to tone back. It could be back to 50%. It could be 75%. It could be, you know, there's a whole bunch of things we can do with that. But yeah, God of War. Okay, so check, God of War is too powerful. Actually, that's something that I've been getting from lots of people everywhere. Maybe, actually, I don't know. Because here's the thing. It is another path to a religion that doesn't require piety, right?
Sure.
So, on one hand, I'm like, that's too strong. On the other hand, it's like, actually, it's really cool. And it does have a little bit of counterplay in that, you know, people can come and screw up your camps if they really want to.
I mean, in that game you're specifying yours, I had Uluru and I had God of War. And I was one of the first, I think I was like second or third pantheon. So you built Stonehenge. Stonehenge is equal in production, equal in faith per turn to Uluru, but I had Uluru turns and turns ahead of before you had Stonehenge. And then I had a pantheon that was stronger than your pantheon. I mean, and you were still only one turn behind. I think if anything, that argues for the strength of piety. You know, you were only one turn behind me on religion, and I had a better pantheon and better faith generation pretty much the entire go of it. I don't know.
Let's not talk about that game, because it could sure take some time, because there are some different things happening as usual in all the games too that actually influence the, you know, I can't say about the social bliss on example of one game. So, patronage?
Yeah. Unless, did you have any stuff, extra thoughts for Trek on Piety?
I'm not sure about what my stance is right now on whether or not people who go piety should get a religion. And the reason why I say that is because too much is in flux with it right now, as in, you know, the follower beliefs need, like, some potential ideas that have been juggled around so far are things like, make it so that there's no follower beliefs that can give you 2 happiness per thing. Like, you know, pagodas and temple would be reduced to 1 happiness, maybe buffed to compensate, maybe not. And make reformation beliefs really, really awesome. And then you don't have to worry about, you know, the religion thing as much. Meaning, you know, it takes a bigger investment than just opening something and getting the best religious beliefs. Does that make sense?
Yeah, for me, it, well, basically how I feel about religion overall and piety, I always hated this from the introduction of religion systems in C5, that basically there are overpowered pantheons, there are overpowered beliefs that you can't compensate even if you invest into getting a religion of your own. So I do agree with the thing that whoever gets the first religion, though it be RNG or on purpose because you invest into trying to get the first religion, you get the best choices. But the other players need to have a choice to get a religion, and they need to have a choice to pick something that is actually at least like 50% useful. Okay, a little bit, well, 50% worse than the guy who gets the religion first. So, like, add, I don't know, Barak's happiness, or one happiness from Barak's for honor people, or like, for just like, I don't know how you feel about the religion stuff and all that. And for me, overall, it was always like, you gotta, if you invest into religion, you gotta get something out of it. So I do like the idea that everybody can have a religion and everybody can have at least a decent stuff from the religion. And now you get the religion war, right? If you want to fight somebody else's religion, you invest into missionaries, inquisitors, so you don't buy stuff out of the religion. So you have a war on the religion side, but you just don't say like, ah, screw it, I didn't get the religion, fuck religion overall, right?
I like that idea, except for the fact that nobody's ever going to do it. Meaning, who is really going to spend their faith on an inquisitor when they need it, when it's critical for things like great scientist or great engineer or great general or other things like that? I really don't think people are going to spend their faith on that kind of stuff. And the other thing that I don't like about having six religions potentially, and I'm not saying that I'm opposed to the idea, but one of the things that gives me concern is the fact that that directly nerfs the beliefs that affect foreign cities, because it becomes that much harder, because holy cities give off a lot of pressure, and so it directly nerfs the ability for you to make foreign cities do things. And I kind of like the fact that, you know, not everyone gets a religion, and you can benefit, like, even without going piety, you can benefit greatly from a religion that someone else invested a whole bunch of stuff into. But I don't know, I mean, it's not that I'm opposed to it, it's just that those are my concerns with making all people get a religion.
Patronage?
Yep.
Okay, cool. So I want to say first up front, I'm going to cut in line just for 10 seconds. The original design for consulates was just flat plus 2 votes. It just, that's it. It's like a forbidden palace, right?
You know, I'm going to say something about it. Huh?
I know. And that's actually the way I wanted to launch it. And literally every person that I showed it to was like, this is the weakest policy ever. And I was like, okay, I think it's strong, but I guess I'll add some votes to it as the game scales. So do you want to go first yours?
Yeah, sure. Patronage, opener, perfectly fine. Not too much to say about that. Philanthropy, also perfectly fine. Scholasticism, I would say that I actually like the idea of boosting this a little bit more in the science that you did get there. Just a tiny little bit, not much, but still 150 science in the late game by having like, yeah, 5, 6, 7 city-state allies or friends. It still feels a little bit small, if you want to do it. So maybe not a huge boost, but just a little boost. Culture diplomacy, perfectly fine in here. Merchant confederacy, the only thing that I have a problem with this policy, though I like the 2 food, 2 production, 2 gold from that. I would even say that you can boost that up, the food production and gold part. I dislike the +2 influence per turn for traders with city states, and there are several reasons for that. First of all, if you get the food production and gold, it's 6, right? So it equals with a cargo, almost like it equals, it's even a little bit better, or it's like balanced with a caravan that you get in, until let's say like Renaissance industrial era. And for that, you get two influence, and two influence per turn is huge. That's huge. So I don't like that part. I was thinking about plus one influence as a change, and I really didn't like that at all. I would like, if I don't know if that's possible even, I would like that the trade route that you send to a city-state just stops the loss of influence in
the city. Exact same idea. Exact same.
Okay, yeah.
So you can boost like food production and gold, so it will be like beneficial. You don't lose like internal trade routes, but influence, I don't like the plus influence. I like stop the loss of influence with the trade route with the city states. So that's about Merchant Confederacy. Consulates, two additional votes is more than enough. The additional delegates for every era, that's just insanely too much. That's seven votes. Now, you could argue like, okay, it allows the diplomacy victory, but it doesn't require from the guy diplomacy victory to actually try to achieve delegates and city states allies early in the game to pay for them, because if they actually choose, let's assume they are equal in science and they choose to go for Forbidden Palace and they do get consulates, so they get already plus four votes. They control the Congress. There's nothing other players can do if they have the equal amount of city states. There's nothing they can do to stop. So now you pass on everything that you want. Previously, you needed to pass religion, get two votes, right? Pass ideology, get two votes. And that allowed you with Forbidden Palace to win the first vote if we were really, really good on getting city-state allies. Like now, you can skip even a couple of city-states, you can skip world religion, you can skip ideology, and boom, first vote, you win diplomatic victory. That's just a little bit too much. And the finisher, just one thing. Overall, I like all of that, but I don't like that militaristic city-states give you two units. I would prefer that they give you units twice fast. Not two units at the same time, just a unit, but 50% faster. And that's basically all that I have to say about patronage.
Okay. Baba, you want to chime in, or are you done? Is Baba even in channel anymore?
I think he might not be able to press his push to talk right now, because I see him on his stream being some kind of VR-ish type game.
Sure, it's probably
not that he's dancing, but with his fingers. His fingers are
muted,
dancing.
I think.
One idea possibly for consulates also that I want to say this before you go, Filthy, so you can consider it as well, is maybe it's just plus one vote, and then later on it's plus one vote per ally that you have as well, kind of like a different
that's too much.
Like globalization
that's too much.
Is
okay
that's
too
much.
All
right. Filthy,
just one
yeah before
just one
I...
note
go on.
Yeah
oops
yeah
go
just
on,
one
yours.
Note to just one note to diplomatic basically the map and city state's randomness of the quest, it's already a lot to the city state allies, right? And now if you add additional votes, basically you need to balance the World Congress mechanics, right? If you just add additional votes, sometimes, like most of the times, if somebody controls the city states, let's assume Greece, let's assume Siam, let's assume any other civ that is good with city states, other players have absolutely no means to counter that. And that's my only problem with giving just flat additional votes. You gotta fight for those city states just a little bit. And patronage as it is right now, it's already so easy with almost no cost to get the city state allies. So, okay, you already have the city-state allies with no cost. Now, if you get even more boost to delegates because you just have them at no cost, it's just a little bit too much, because other players need to so much more to fight for those allies if they want to stop you from victory. So it's just, for now, it's just too easy mode, for me at least. That's my feeling.
Okay, dokie. What were you going to say, Filthy?
I actually just wanted to touch on one thing in Piety that I kind of like blanked on as I was talking about it, which is that
it's eating into your timer, Bucko.
Whatever. So the emphasis on the Grand Temple as a focus, like it gives the gold and the science, is basically a second national college for that, is really problematic with Piety in the sense that Piety is a civ that's designed to go wide. So all the piety, all the faith bonuses are better the wider your cities are, but you don't have any benefit. You don't have any production bonuses to building a very, very late national building. You have to build temples in all your cities, and then you have to build a grand temple. So if you want to do that, you might need some sort of production bonus towards a grand temple specifically.
Yeah, you get all double speed to temp with the opener.
Does that include the grand temple?
Or grand temple as the piety finisher?
I could change that. I mean, that's easy. But yeah, sure. Okay, I get what you're saying now. Sorry.
So patronage.
Patronage, yes.
Okay, so the opener is just fine. I like it. It's pretty much the same as it was, right? So that's fine.
Yeah, I didn't change it.
First point is good. Philanthropy is very good. It's very good, but it's not overpowered. Scholasticism, funny you are. So I just played a game recently. I was making 300 science with 6 city-state allies. 100 of my science was coming directly from the city-states. In other words, 1/3 of my science in the medieval era was coming from city-state allies. And that's crazy.
So real quick, I want to make sure, I forgot to do this. I'm sorry, Filthy.
You were in the game, yours.
That's what I'm saying.
The thing is, with the actual numbers in city-state science, what I did was I looked at average science figures in each era and made it so that, and numbers that would make it, well, I picked a formula, generally works with this, that if you get 3 city-state allies, you'll have about a 10% boost to your science, about, right? In the mid-game, it peaks a little bit more than that, and in the early game, it's less, and in the late game, it's a lot less. So
okay.
It's kind of a mid-game spike of science. So
sure.
In the Renaissance or Industrial era.
My experience with it was I did an honor patronage game, right? And my experience was that I, with no investment, like almost no gold spent, I farmed a couple barb camps near them and had honor, so I was farming the camps anyways and just killed some stuff near them and then ran a couple trade routes. I was getting 6 city-state allies, and I was getting 1/3 of my science from them. So yours thinks is underpowered. My experience was it was very strong. If you guys are thinking it's fine as is, my initial play around with that was that it was very, very strong. Not necessarily needs to be nerfed, but very, very strong. Okay, let's move on to cultural diplomacy. This policy needs to be changed slightly. I like what it gives, but the problem is it's kind of RNG, whether or not a city-state has a unique luxury, and you don't get to choose which city-states you ally. Mostly you get stuck by quests. So I really would like it to be, instead of the quantity, the happiness from gifted luxuries increased by 50%, I need it to be something like, you know, maybe just a flat bonus per city that you have as an ally or something like that, right? Cities don't give you luxuries until they're an ally. How about it's a flat bonus happiness per city that you have as an ally? So it gets away from the fact that, oh, there's 15 city-states on a map and 12 of them have copper as their fucking luxury. Merchant Confederacy, I have similar concerns to yours. I actually think the food production and gold could scale based on era. I don't think it needs to be a flat bonus, but I think the 2 influence per turn is way too good. I'm okay exactly with what Yoruus said, which is that when you're running a trade route to that city state, you don't lose influence per turn with them. I'm fine with that. That works out to be about probably similar actually with patronage, right? You're probably getting it's because patronage is like a quarter off, and then your religion's like a quarter off. So you're probably only losing like 0.75 or 0.55 influence per turn anyways. But I don't need it to add 2. 2 was too much. It was too easy to ally city-states. I just picked 2 cities of mine, and I had each of them run a trade route, and even hostile city-states were mine in a pretty reasonable amount of time. But I think it's too powerful, the influence portion of that. The consulates was too strong. Just the number of votes it was giving me at no cost was too strong. So it needs to be toned down a little bit. I don't care how.
Do you think +2 flat is good?
+2 flat is good? I think that's a pretty decent one, honestly. That's a strong number of votes.
Okay, perfect.
And the finisher is a fucking pile of shit and needs to be buffed immediately. The double units, I like that. I thought that was a nice change to double units, but I don't think it matters either way. It could be double units or 1 unit. Most of the time, city-state gifted units don't influence the game very much at all. Double units is fine. You want to do double units or you want to give units twice as fast, I don't care. That's the same thing. It's just, that's fine. I don't care about that. What I care about is the gifted great people. This is supposed to be a big deal. The problem is the gifted great people you get almost always fucking suck. You can get an artist, a musician, a writer. All those kind of suck. You can get 2 different types of generals. Those are kind of situationally beneficial, and 99% of the time when you need a great person, you're not going to get the one you need, and you're not going to get the general when you need it. Instead, you're going to get the general when you don't need it, so they kind of fucking suck. Merchants kind of suck compared to engineers or scientists. And Oh, and you can get two different types of merchants, because you can get Great Merchants of Venice. You can get the Khan, the General, the Great Merchant of Venice, and the Great Merchant. And all of those piss me the fuck off. If I have this closer that's supposed to be great, and city-states are giving me stuff, why can't they give me useful great people? So we either need to change the proportions around or change the spawning times. I had six allies for like 100 turns. I got gifted like three great people. I got gifted a general, a musician, and an, I think, an artist. And it was, I'm like, this is useless. So that portion of that finisher needs to be changed in some way, because it's currently really frustratingly, painfully useless.
Okay. Okie dokie.
Donation. We love donations.
Okay. I don't really have anything to say. I think your guys' feedback is good.
Donation for $5 from Chad Wicos. Loving like the discussion.
For the boost to awesome. Faith and culture. Like, that's an awesome boost.
Yeah, that part's great. Passive. Yeah, that part's great. I'm sorry. I'm talking about the great people of gifting. The benefit from the rest is really good. The actual amount of stuff you get is awesome. That's really cool.
So, okay. Because your words were, the finisher is a something pile of shit.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm talking specifically about the great person gifts of that.
Okay, great. Good to confirm that. I'll write that down. I thought it was like, okay, I guess I'll redo the finisher.
Sorry, I wasn't clear on that. And also, for a second, none of this feedback is personal to you. Like, I'm not being like, you're really shit at balancing this game. I'm talking about how the... Okay, good, good.
Right now.
Good. What were you saying? Loosen your asshole? I think maybe that was your code you were using earlier.
Oh, maybe don't worry. I got my traffic cone ready. Oh, I didn't say that? Anyway.
Dude, it's anal training.
I forgot I was streaming for a second there. Lols. I'm joking, by the way. I don't have it going.
Right now.
Okay, no, I don't have one ever. Actually, I lied. When I do boot stuff, we jump over traffic cones. So I do technically have them, but they're at work.
No need to explain.
Okay. Anyway, boot camp meaning exercise. Sorry, that's an LA thing. In Los Angeles, everyone calls the exercise classes boot camp for some reason because they want to seem cool. Okay, so... do you guys have anything else? We can move on to aesthetics, right?
Yeah.
Well,
all right, aesthetics? Let's do it.
I'm moderating him, so. Done.
Oh, you like it as is now?
Yeah, I have no bloody ideas how to improve aesthetics. Overall, I have the feeling that still the amount of extra culture that is put in all the different trees does not scale with extra trees you can get out of aesthetics, but I have no ideas how to fix that. So I'm done for now.
More policies with the finisher. We'll give it 4 free policies now. I'm kidding, by the way. Okay, Filthy?
I have similar concerns to yours. Again, like, the goal was to get it away from being a tourism-only policy, right? Because tourism's not that great in multiplayer, and we don't want it to be a social policy tree that you can only get if you're going tourism. And currently, for a while, with the double social policies, it was basically a investment, right? It was an investment. You put points in it now, you don't get the immediate payoff from the other stuff you could have been doing, but the end result of putting those points in aesthetics is you're going to get more culture late game to put in more social policies later. And we kind of thought that was a little overpowered because the problem was the timing on it, right? You could put points into aesthetics long before you could put points into rationalism, but then the payoff from aesthetics could be directly applied to rationalism to give you huge science gains later. It was basically a way of banking points prior to rationalism. The problem is now.
One second. I have to put the headset down for a second because someone locked the door and I have to let my boyfriend in. I'll be right back like 10 seconds later.
Yep, no problem. I'll hold on. Doing all right, Yoruus?
What?
You doing okay?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
I'm back. Fine.
All right. So my problem with aesthetics right now is that, yes, the nerf was the problem isn't aesthetics again, it's rationalism. That's always the fucking problem. Every time you look at social policy trees, the problem is rationalism. So I like the aesthetics as it was, but rationalism needs to be changed.
I would agree with that.
Everything else about it wasn't particularly overpowered. It wasn't even particularly great. All I was ever doing when I was putting points in aesthetics was being like, okay, I don't give a shit about what these policies do. I just want their cultural return later to put into other policies. And I like that. I like that. That's a long-term investment. That's cool.
There's one more little thing about aesthetics, though. The timing with aesthetics, if you have a good game, allows you to put the free social policy straight to ideology, if you get ideology first. If you want to have foreign legions at your borders instantly, that's always cool.
I mean, is that any different than, like, timing a push with a specific unit you can build because you Oxforded into it way earlier than you'd normally get it?
It's maybe not like the push into, well, timing push, but what I'm trying to say basically, something that Philly said, banking culture and actually getting much, much more extra culture for the late game. It feels a tiny little bit out of balance with, because what do you balance out with aesthetics right now? Let's say you do full tradition game, you do full liberty game, you do full honor game, you do full piety game as the openers, right? And then you want to put points into something, right? So you have two choices, patronage, aesthetics. Patronage, very situational, because like the chance for culture city states on the map is quite small, and still the amount of culture that you can get at this stage of the game just from patronage and allying city states is nothing close to finishing aesthetics. So let's say you want to have a good science game, you finish out aesthetics, you've got a such a huge advantage. Ideology, I don't know, factory science instantly, boom, rationalists, I don't need it, I don't care, I want to kill somebody with foreign legions, boom, I do it. Or do I want to get extra policy and rationalists? No problem. I feel personally for aesthetics, it's, as I said, like all the culture stuff is great, but it doesn't help tourism victory. And I don't know, like, you don't want tourism victory in multiplayer. I want it personally.
How does it not help? Can you explain more?
I have to disagree with that as well. You can get 100% boost to tourism in all cities, and the culture that you get on all the improvements now turns into tourism.
You
at
didn't
hotels.
Listen to me at the start because you added tons of culture in the other trees. Honor, liberty, piety, especially honor and piety. You added tons of culture into those trees. This, and not only that, you also slowed down overall science of the game, which means at the moment when you could have, basically it's a matter of balance from, you don't notice that until industrial era, but you notice this in the after atomic era, you notice first of all the slowdown science, like the research lab are in different, well, it's in the same spot, but you're not forced into going to research labs if you want to go kill somebody. But at the late game, culture amounts that you see right now with modded games in the late game when somebody has a strong game are ridiculous, redundant, because aesthetics also helps culture. So if somebody just opens aesthetics, there's no way to beat that.
I agree with yours there. No, it doesn't work that way because everyone's getting better culture. I think this is an easy fix that doesn't revolve aesthetics at all, which is straight up right now. Just like give 50% more tourism to fucking everything. I'm fine with that. I don't even think that would be imbalanced.
Oh, I see what you're saying. You mean for the tourism victory? That's what
you're saying. He's saying that the relative proportion of tourism to culture has been upped in the favor of culture. Because of all the changes to the trees.
So let me speak to that real quick with tourism victory and diplomatic victory. So I totally want them to be viable options. I really, really, really do. And I get that there used to be, you know, kind of a what is it called in autocracy? I'm blanking on it. Futurism. There was a futurism thing you could do to get a tourism victory, right? And that was like a way to do it. And doing hard tourism was pretty much... I mean, do you guys agree that doing hard tourism without mod was impossible?
My feeling on the tourists basically before the mod was, if you're going up against good players that have a similar game and they're not like behind a couple of eras or techs, there is no way to achieve futurism aesthetics, futurism victory. No way. No way in hell. Futurism alone can allow you to win tourism victory against good players. Against good players, the way you win tourism is by hard tourism. And now hard tourism at the end of the game, if you're having a very good game, I might add to that, like, if you're having a bad science game, bad production game, if you go tourism, you're dead anyways, right? Unless you're going against situational stuff on the map. But if you're going up against good players, hard tourism victory was achievable around turn 180, 190. Still situational, I might add, but was achievable by hard tourism. Futurism alone never could happen there. With mod changes, I have a personal feeling if you're going up against a guy who have a very strong game and actually fills out aesthetics, I feel it's impossible to achieve a tourism victory on hard tourism alone.
Yeah. I could, as okay. I said, I could okay. see, I could happily see a 50% increase to all tourism output in all forms and still not think that's that big a deal.
Yeah, I agree with that. So the mod was, I mean, obviously it's still in beta. The things that I wanted to focus on first were domination and science victory, because those two were the most viable before, and they tend to be the most
prevalent.
They tend to make the most
engaging
games.
I'm sorry, I'll be
back
in 1 minute.
Okay, sure. Yeah, they tend to make the most engaging games. I totally want tourism and diplomacy to also be viable victory paths, and I haven't focused on them at all. So, cultural victory is actually my favorite type in the game. I love it. I love doing it. It is definitely my favorite. So I want one day for it to be totally viable. But yes, okay, cool. So we don't have problems with aesthetics tree giving this much culture, but the thing that we have to realize then is it blocks tourism victory. Is that the correct?
Not quite. The problem is that it's the idea of the aesthetics tree being a cultural multiplier is cool. The problem is, where does that cultural multiplier get dumped into? Does it get dumped into overpowered
yes.
trees like rationalism or potentially ideologies? And the answer tends to be yes. And the ideologies as a whole don't tend to be too overpowered, although they're very strong, but rationalism is overpowered because it's science.
Yeah. Oh boy, that's going to be a long one when we get there.
Yeah.
Okay. I think we can probably move on to commerce. Is that okay?
Yeah. Let's wait for yours to get back.
Okay. Well, you could go first if you want.
Although I expect that yours will have... I prefer it actually just to wait to yours for a minute. I'll grab another beer. It'll take 2 seconds. You want to take like a 2-minute break?
Yeah, I'll go get some...
You can go change out your traffic cone and I'll grab another beer.
Sounds good.
All right, see you in a minute.
Yours is back.
Oh, what? Okay. Yours, Filthy just ran to get a beer. I'm gonna get a drink real quick, and then I'll be right back in like 30 seconds.
All right.
Working. Yes, sizing. Back.
Okay, I'm yeah. back too.
All right, Yoruus, you want to start on commerce?
Yeah, sure. Oh my goodness, this is the last that I prepared for today.
Okay.
And most of it is okay. anyways, opener. Fine with that. I was a little bit thinking about the nerfing a little bit, 25%, but actually I like it. 50% is perfect, though the other trees is only 25. I like 50% to generating great merchants. It fits nicely. I did play a commerce game, and actually getting the great merchant was especially good with the addition of mercantilism. I like that social policy very, very much. Plus one food from every custom house is amazingly good. I tremendously like that change. It's just bloody great at mercantilism. I love it. Rest of the stuff, Silk Road, perfectly fine. Mercenary army, also fine. Rest of the changes rest of the social policy is really, really good. Though overall, as the commerce tree, is just redundantly strong. I was reaching 600 gold per turn with around 8 10 cities. And the changes, like when you get entrepreneurship or whatever you call it, and changes with Silk Road, was such a huge boost to gold income is beyond belief. Maintenance reduced by 50% is just amazing. But I still like it. I still like it. Protectionism is fine. It's okay. About the finisher, I want to talk a little bit about the finisher and overall about the commerce relation with the other stuff. Finisher, I was thinking about adding actually plus one food to trade posts, but it feels to me redundantly strong. But also it complements all the commerce very, very well. And I would like that commerce to be everything related to cargo ships, naval trade routes, and caravans, just trade that involves gold, would be put in commerce and not to exploration. I don't know about your changes to exploration. I didn't check out exploration in any way, shape, or form.
I haven't changed it.
Yeah, but what I would like, actually, commerce to be the tree that just is also cargo ships and caravans, everything put in commerce that resolves into trading gold with every others, with city-states or other civilizations. Now, the problem with commerce for me, though, as I said, 600 gold dropped to 400 gold without cargo ships and any caravans run into city-states or other players because war and, you know, like city trading bans. Still, 400 gold a turn. You get great merchants, but with fate, super great merchants, autocrossing.
Did you have that, commerce. By the way, did you have the full tree filled out when that was happening?
Yes.
Full tree. All right.
Full tree, commerce, autocracy, not a chance. Every other player who does not pick commerce and autocracy, fate buying, there's no way to compensate this amount of gold by hammers.
Okay.
And it was sort of possible before, though still very good gold game with commerce plus autocracy and Big Ben. It was really, really hard to do anything against an equally science guy just with hammers. So still like that balance, the tons of gold that you get out of commerce right now, plus autocracy, when you're at the same tech level, I feel like it's really, really too strong. And in a month or two, this is going to be the only way to play late game. Commerce, autocracy, honor. Only way to play the late game if you want to go to war. Science victory is just not going to be possible anymore.
Right. Okay. Too much gold. I think it's just a matter of numbers. Honestly, when I made the tree, I was like, I want people to try it, so I just picked big numbers. I think the tree was definitely.
I think I need to upload that game. On a side note, I was playing. I had two. I killed two players, and I was on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 6, 7 cities or so, maybe 8, and I had the exact same gold income as a tradition guy on 4 cities. So he still was he still managed, it was QBS, he still managed to pull off 4 cities 600 gold also with commerce.
He had commerce as well?
Yep.
Okay, all right.
So it was commerce war, but because I had 10 cities, I could buy more bombers and planes and stuff. And I had more hammers. So in the end, like, the amount of city wins, not the, like, amount of gold. But that's, of course, situational. But just the crazy amounts of...
Yoruus is such a long-winded
stuff
guy.
You can buy instantly.
All right, Yoruus.
It's just ridiculous. Like,
you're like a half ridiculous. Hour, Yoruus.
Yeah, I'm done.
Okay, you want to talk filthy?
Drink that beer, filthy.
All right. Just first off, I think Patrick, I don't think there needs to be 4 different tiers of availability for the social policy trees, right? I don't think we need some available at Classic, some available at Ancient, some available at Medieval, and some available at Renaissance, because I think it makes it too difficult to balance them relative to each other, and I don't think we need to start there. So why don't we just fucking do away with? I think classical for patronage and aesthetics is fine. I think commerce and exploration and potentially rationalism, when we rebalance the shit out of that tree, should all be available at classical as well. Because you're basically deciding what is your secondary tree going to be. And the options ought to really be between the ones so they can be competitive to each other. So is commerce strong? Yeah. Is patronage strong? Yeah. Hopefully, is the status going to be strong? Yeah. You know, but it's a comparison. It's right. Which of these strong trees do I want to choose from? I don't mind that social policies are strong, but they need to be competitive with each other, not one-sided or available at different times. All right. Individual bonuses. I still think great merchants need to be stronger than they are. I don't care about planting them, although if you want to make planting bonuses stronger, so be it. But I don't think the yield they get from city-states is all that impressive. As for the gold per turn, I have not yet done a strong commerce game, so Yoruus has probably more experience than I do with that in the late game. I have messed around with some of the early policies on that. I liked Mercenary Army. I liked the combination of the purchasing units plus the useless fucking pikemen. That's cool. I like the Silk Road bonus. That was really cool. I haven't tested the mercantilism bonus itself, but even just 1 food and 4 gold from custom houses still seems a little bit weak to me, because you're talking the difference now of like 8 gold a turn and 1 food versus something like 600 to 1,000 gold. And the time to return that, plus the influence, the time to return on that is still a little bit high for me. So either the gold return needs to be better off of these, or they need to give some other bonus as well, possibly a production bonus. The food is a good start, but I still think great merchants planting them needs a bonus. Entrepreneurship, production, and culture from the East India Trading Company. I guess the East India Trading Company got a buff, but that part of it seems pretty minor to the real buff of that policy. The real buff of that policy is maintenance paid on buildings. That's a very strong bonus. I mean, have you looked at what that is likely to be at any given time in the game? Because it seems like it's probably a lot. You know, if you're talking between
200, 250 G,
chewing.
It's about 200 gold for you, Yoruus? Just entrepreneurship on its own? That's huge.
I can check it out if you're really interested.
Yeah.
It depends on how many cities you have ultimately. Like, that's obviously that's a wide policy in general.
Sure, but even
save more money the more buildings
but,
you have.
Oh, yes and no, but I mean, like, tall cities are going to have more buildings per city than wide cities, so it's probably not quite as pronounced as you think between one and the other. But I mean, what are you talking about, like, late game? Like, probably talking 20 buildings, with the building upkeep being between 1 and 2 each, between in 4 cities, so we're talking 80 buildings with between 1 and 2 gold per turn each. That's a ton. I mean, that's a huge bonus.
I mean, let's assume they're all 2 gold each, then that means you're going to be saving about 80 gold.
80 gold with per turn. 20, all right, 20, 20, okay, 2 gold each, 4 cities at 20, it's 80. Yeah. Okay, yep.
Yeah, that's 80
that's,
gold per turn.
Sure, that's
a significant
lot.
Significant amount.
And that's before multipliers, right?
No. The building maintenance happens at the end on the Empire level, so it doesn't affect any kind of multipliers.
Okay. Play with the numbers. I don't have a strong sense. I haven't played the tree yet, or haven't played the tree deeply. I've only played it like the surface level of the tree, and I found it strong from the beginning. But I don't know. I don't know why the.
I think the majority of gold from the tree is coming from the fact that you get the gold from trading posts in tier one instead of finisher. Honestly, I know that sounds kind of silly, but that's been like a huge amount of gold that comes from the tree.
Wait, where is that?
Well, I gotta say,
trading post? Yeah,
I actually don't agree with that. I check
either.
This game out. It's like I'm looking at turn 154 right now, and I'm making 508 gold, and I don't have trading posts. Now, you're probably asking why do I don't have trading posts. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 planted merchants in my capital. And
that's true. Yeah, customs house as well.
Yeah, it's oscillating around 500, 600 at turn 150. And I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 cities, and they are not huge cities. But it's still like 600 gold a turn, banked 4,300 something, obviously playing soon and stuff like that. It's a lot.
All right, I do want to say, though, I like the idea. When you balance this tree for strike, I don't mind it being strength related to fragility, right? So trade routes are fragile. City connections are fragile. Things that revolve around city-state trading are fragile because they can be intercepted and broken. So I don't necessarily mind it being a strong tree as long as it has vulnerabilities that can be exploited back and forth, right? So I don't think it needs to be like, oh my god, we're getting gold from this. Yeah, okay, that's fine. That's the point of the policy, right? Is to get gold out of this. So it can be strong. It just needs to be balanced strong. And I don't know. I haven't played it enough to say that either way.
Yeah, Yoruus, can you have the save open right now, you said, right?
Yeah.
Can you hover over your money display, the money summary thingy at the top? And
get back in line for the formats?
Okay, yeah. give me a second. Oh, I had the video opened.
Oh, okay. Oh, whoops. Never mind. It's okay. It's not that important. We can do it later. I have a question. Neither one of you guys mentioned the trade routes and the finisher. How is that?
Too strong?
Well, haven't used it.
It's still the exact same thing that Filthy says. At the end of the game, two extra cargo ships can be easily countered. Well, cargo ships, caravans. Cargo ships and caravans as a means to get gold is easy countered by ban city-states or just declare the war out of you or just pillage the stuff. So at the end of the game, for example, I had like, I don't know, 14 trade routes or so. Because I had Petra and other stuff, 14. I would need to check. Never mind. But what I'm trying to say, I was using 8, maybe. And that's it. Because there was like user one city that I could trade with from the other player who actually did not declare war on me. So it's easy to counter the extra cargo, the two extra trade routes. It doesn't, in the late game or at the time when actually commerce finishes, it doesn't influence the game that much. At that stage of the game, two extra caravans or two extra cargo ships does not mean that much.
And I bet you it's broken as fucking single player because the AI won't touch it. But I bet you in multiplayer it doesn't matter.
It's so broken. Everything. I'm so sorry. I'm eating. But everything in the game is totally broken single player. And it's glorious.
All right. I don't. Yoruus, you haven't. Neither of us can make any points about exploration because we haven't seen his new draft or haven't looked at his new draft of that, right?
Yeah, I'll just briefly speak to that real quick. So Yoruus, what you said is exactly what I wanted to do and what I actually did do so far, which is, you know, actually hold on, give me a second so I can chew this up and swallow real quick. Don't make a joke on that, Filthy.
I went there.
Oh, but you are listening, Fruitstrike. Just
okay.
About that,
I'm ready.
I think.
But go ahead.
Yeah, I don't know if you changed something in air combat, but I think something about intercept sweep promotion is a little bit broken in planes.
I didn't change anything with any. I never changed anything that existed yet, except that I created a new promotion that was the same as a different promotion for stealth bombers, which had 75 evasion instead of 100. And
yeah, because
I interception
was...
like giant death robots.
I don't care about single player at all.
From
not
my
you.
Experience,
there was just...
bug. Basically, if you have promoted intercept, if you have interception promoted fighters and they intercept sweep promotion fighters, the interception promoted fighters take like triple the amount of damage that the sweeping
really?
Fighters do. Yeah.
Yeah, I haven't changed anything about that stuff. I'm not sure what that is. We'll have to I mean, it's possible that something that I did indirectly change. I can't think of anything because I only changed things in the XML that had to do with that kind of stuff. But
I was just
the
wondering.
C++ code I didn't.
Not,
yeah.
Not super important, but I was just wondering because that was my experience from that game. I need to upload that game because it's actually maybe educational for the mechanics a little bit.
Yoruus, if you get a moment, okay. Why don't you test that? You can. I've tested some stuff before using Hot Seat. So you just start an info era and then like do some gold purchasing and purchase a couple fighters and play both sides of like a 1v1 duel. You play both sides. And I'd be really curious to see about that interception versus air sweeping, if that is just a bug you can confirm. I've never seen that.
Yeah. Okay, so what you were saying about exploration, all the cargo ship stuff being moved to commerce and all the gold stuff, that's exactly what I wanted to do. So there was treasure fleets in exploration was +4 gold from sea trade routes, and wagon trains was +2 gold from land trade routes. So I just combined them and just made it so that it's +4 gold no matter what kind of trade route you have. And that's the Silk Road one. I felt weird still calling it wagon trains when it was like, you know, naval vessels, but who cares anyway.
Right.
And then the production and culture from East India Trade Company, I pulled that over as well because markets are what you use to build it and markets are gold building, so I put it in commerce. That right there is like one and a half of the policies in exploration. The other three policies that matter in exploration, like the maritime infrastructure and the happiness and the gold from Lighthouse, I think honestly they could just be merged into one policy and that would be a reasonable policy at that time in the game, you know? Like one production, one gold, and one happiness from Lighthouse, Harbor, and Seaport, because it's only going to benefit coastal empires anyway. But that, you know, let's not get into exploration right now because it's not changed right now and I don't even have a draft for it, so.
Yep, I think just try to keep, when you do make changes to it, try to keep in mind that if you're going to be, I think commerce should be at the same time as aesthetics and patronage, and I think exploration should be as well. If you're going to do that, just try to keep them relatively equal in power so you can make decisions between them based on circumstance mm-hmm. or goals. All right, rationalism yours?
Go ahead.
I gotta honestly say that I don't have too much to say about rationalism in general. I like the changes. The only problem I do have with rationalism right now, the science is out of balance right now. Well, maybe it's a good thing, maybe it's a bad thing, but my personal feeling that, not like maybe related to like science victory or war attacks and all that stuff, but science is a little bit out of balance for, let's say, tourism victory and diplomatic victory. I don't know if this is the reason because of the change of rationalism or other things needs to be changed. Overall, I like the rationalism. I do have only one problem, and the problem is scientific revolution. Now, this free technology comes at a stage of the game when you can enter in modern era. You don't need to use Oxford. If you have a strong science game, you can scientific revolution into modern era. I feel this is a little bit out of balance because you need to pick that social policy at some point of the game. And the timing right now is perfect for modern era. So you still got to get this technology, but you're guaranteed, most of the time, you're guaranteed first ideology without any cost, because you don't go industrialization, you just pick public schools, usual science route, and you scientific revolution into modern era instantly. I don't like that spot for this particular social policy, but I also don't have an idea where to put it. Actually, the rest I like, though I still feel like trading posts, as well as in commerce and in rationalism, should add plus one food. I don't know, scientists maybe too. If you got plus one food from merchants in the commerce tree, I see no reason why you do not get plus one food from engineers, you don't get plus one food from scientists. Though the problem is, I don't exactly know how to balance that things out because it could be a little bit too powerful. But overall, I like the idea of putting plus one food on tiles like great person improvements and trading post improvement. The rest, I think that rationalism, the way it is right now, feels very comfortable. It slows down the science. It feels a little bit out of balance, the science game for now, but I also don't know where to change stuff to actually get it into the balance with other stuff.
I do.
I have a couple of ideas, but I want to hear yours, Filthy, first, and then I'll let you know what I've been writing down and making draft-wise.
All right, rationalism needs to go as it is. All the policies in it except sovereignty are bad for the game as a whole. You can't have a science-based policy that applies early enough that it affects the end game of Civ without there being problems. You can't do it. Every time we look at this, all policies that, for example, aesthetics right now, is overpowered because of rationalism. Not because of aesthetics, but because of rationalism. Rationalism is fucking overpowered every time you pick it up because you're forced to be competitive in science, you're forced to pick up rationalism. And that should not be that way. It should not be an obligatory, mandatory fucking policy. It's bad for the game. So if you want to leave rationalism, if you want to keep rationalism as a social policy tree, which clearly we're going to, we need to do things to remove the science directly. I'm okay with indirect science boosts, but not permanent science boosts and not direct science boosts, right? So things like production towards science buildings, or bonuses towards spying, or bonuses towards anti-spying, or generating later era growth buildings for free, like aqueducts or medical lab, not aqueducts, like medical labs or hospitals, or things that affect science indirectly, but aren't a direct plus science for production specialists or plus science percentages. Those things need to fucking go. So I don't like scientific revolution. I don't like free thought. I don't like secularism. I don't like humanism. And I'm not all that keen on the finisher or the opener. So I don't quite know what to do with it, but it's gotta be changed away for that. So, because otherwise you're gonna force people to take it.
So, okay. So I don't completely agree with you, Filthy, but the sentiment I do agree with in general. I think I actually really like scientific revolution a lot because it gives, it depends where it's put in the tree, right? Like, I think Yoruus is right that maybe the timing is off right now of exactly where it is in the tree. But the reason why I like it is because opener. It allows, possibly opener, yeah.
Actually, I take that back. Sorry, not to interrupt, but I like it better than, I'm going to interrupt anyway, sorry. So I like it better where it is than where it was because the timing is earlier, so it's less influential. It's, it's going to be not nanotechnology, it's going to be something like modern era, which is a big deal still. But nevertheless, earlier was better because it has less of an impact. Now, I don't know that one point in rationalism is good either, because it needs to be deep enough that you can't just throw a point in the tree for a free tech, but I don't know that I like the mechanic at all. Sorry.
Okay, so free tech I really like. I think free thought is great, actually. I don't mind having science from trading posts. You have to actively make a trading post instead of something else that's better. I think it's fine.
There's nothing better on a jungle tile than a trading post, though. So it just benefits people with jungles.
Okay, and you could potentially put trading posts in other places, too. That's like a choice that you want to make, right? Like, it at least allows the option. I hate humanism. I hate secularism. I hate the finisher. I'm actually not too terribly upset with the opener. I don't think that's 25% is a great scientist points. That's a good policy. That's really good, right? But I don't think it's necessarily bad and has to go. I think sovereignty needs to be happiness instead of gold from science.
I'll be right back in 1 minute. I need to fix the cat. I'm sorry.
Fix the cat fix manually?
The cat. Oh my gosh. Yeah, that thing. You should have spaded that thing a long time ago.
He's got like a pair of scissors and like gloves. I got fixed too.
Did you say spaded?
I did.
I'm that was a derpasaur. Okay, anyway. Other things that I was thinking of putting. So I don't mind the fact that there is a science-based tree in the game, and I agree with you that the flat science boosts are really bad. In terms of, like, you have to do them, period. So, like, here's some other potential things to add to the tree. This is all just, like, random ideas. None of this is, like, drafted or anything. So, things like maybe there's the ability later on to buy spaceship parts with faith. Maybe there is not just gold, but happiness from science buildings, production towards science buildings, science from other kinds of tile improvements depending on what empires might potentially need. Like, maybe it's just great people tile improvements, you know? I don't know. There's a couple of different things. Trade routes can produce, like, maybe internal trade routes start producing science just like you would if they were connected to someone else. Or
stay away from direct science posts. So you've just given me, like, you gave me, like, two indirect ones, which were, like, production towards science buildings and, like, something else towards science buildings. And then you gave me, like, five more direct ones, like science from trade routes and science from... You either have to make the amount of... But you have to either... Well, maybe... You either have to give the amount of science in there so minimal that it doesn't matter, in which case, fuck the tree to begin with, or everyone has to start taking that again. Because the bulk of the time, your internal trade routes are not going to be contested. If so, they're giving you 10 or 15 or 20% fucking science, you have no choice but to pick that up.
But if it were external trade routes give you extra science, right? Suddenly you have a way to stop people who have it. Just like you can stop them with the trade routes that they have through commerce, you could do the same exact thing to rationalism.
Except like, gold because commerce, the gold is, the production is a moment-to-moment issue, right? So the production is, every moment you're at war, your production is incredibly vital. So if that gets disrupted mid-war, that hurts. The science is not that way. The science is like, it's not moment to moment. It's like prior to war, right? So there's going to be those long periods of peace. That's just how it is. There's going to be periods of peace in that game, right? Where if you're just teching, you tech faster than them, and then war is no longer possible. You see the difference?
Yes. So the other possibility is You said we're not going to change rationalism. I'm not 100% sure that is, like, I mean, sorry, not change it from being the word rationalism or whatever. I don't see anything wrong with potentially saying instead of rationalism, it's imperialism. And it has to do with, because that's about the time frame, you know, that's in the Renaissance. Why not make it so that it's about, like, founding new cities and trying to become more enlightened?
I'm sure. I'm fine with that. Like, as I said, fuck rationalism. Remove it. If you took rationalism, you took the ration off of that and called it imperialism, I'm totally fine with that. I've all got no science bonuses.
I'm going to call it fruitism.
That's right. You could call it conism for all I care. It's not anything to do with science.
Nice. I think I missed some stuff.
Yeah. Well, it's okay. We talked about stuff that I think you basically agree with. Because of what you said before, the flat science boosts just are too much.
Right.
This is preaching about this. Rationalism is terrible for the game.
So yeah, rationalism, I mean, it definitely has to be changed. Something has to happen because like you said, aesthetics wasn't OP, rationalism was OP, and aesthetics enabled it, and that's the only reason. I just got a message from Slipping to remove tributing. I just want to point that out.
Yeah, you should ignore that.
Overall, right now, Civ has overall several combination problems. Now, the first problem, obviously, is rationalism. The scaling on the science is just... Okay, I'm not going to use that word. And the other stuff is things like gold, gold buying units, gold buying stuff, basically ideologies, the combination between commerce and ideologies. And for now, all the stuff that we are doing, you are doing, Fruitstrike, basically changes early game, mid game, let's say industrialization stuff. Now the late game, the composition between commerce, rationals, ideologies, the amount of extra culture, the amount of social policies you can get, it just gets out of hand against some of the combinations. And for example, commerce autocracy, patronage commerce autocracy, like the early social policies stop to mean that much because like the late game combinations with aesthetics and all the other stuff, the numbers are just ridiculous right now. It's just my feeling.
I would agree with that. Great. I agree. The numbers are too high. I'm sort of okay with that right now, just because, like I said, it's testing things to find out where the right values are, you know? Like, I mean, it is only version 5. But yes, I totally agree with you. I think that the numbers are too high for just generally about everything.
It's still the problem, basically. This is still quick speed, right? So it's still the matter of quick speed as well, basically, because, you know, like the stuff that you get, sometimes it's just, okay, you get this stuff and you're like, oh yeah, I'm flying around with crossbows and boom, I get foreign legions in the face, right?
Okay. I mean, that's also can be fixed with maybe the Foreign Legion thing is just too strong. Maybe instead of being tier 2, it needs to be tier 3.
I had the same exact thought yesterday. So, okay, so are we done with the social policy streams for the moment? Where do we want to go next? Also, we're coming off pretty heavily moving away from the format we kind of started on, and partially because Arvius didn't bother showing up and Baba doesn't want to talk.
I hate that guy.
Yeah, right? So,
yeah.
The point being that, do we want to go back to some sort of format, or are we kind of happy how it's going? Because it seems like we're spending more time on these things and not necessarily being more productive.
All right, Filthy, you can be the 30-second timer, man.
Yes! Yes!
We done.
Otherwise,
this already.
I give you a cone, and that's your done. Sit on the fucking cone.
We're done with social policies, I'm sorry.
But I'm reserving the right to do impromptu interruptions.
That's fine.
Because I won't do many of them, probably.
Alright, so what do we want to touch next? The policies? The pantheons? Or do we want to do just general stuff that the mod has changed and talk about that? Do we want to go blow by blow on the changes, or what?
I would like to say something about the religion still.
Yeah.
I want to repeat
Cone of Silence, Echo Marcher, perfect. Sorry to interrupt yours. This is for you, Fruitstrike. My chat is calling it now the Cone of Silence. Anyways, go on.
Basically, after added all of those cool pantheons, which are tremendously cool, I still I know it's like people don't like the idea of getting more religions. People like the idea of getting more religions. I feel like if you mess up with pantheons right now, and you've got tons of pantheons that are so good for generating fate, the who gets the religion gets even more random than it was. Because, you know, the map still decides if you're going to get the religion or not. And even the piety opener plus the fate will still can change the stuff, but still can be even with zero influence on that. So if you're going to add stuff to the religions, you can. I'm opting for an option that you still get the six religions, you still get tons of great pantheons, you add tons of enhancer beliefs, tons of followers beliefs that are actually useful, maybe not that good.
I'm way louder than the others. First religion, I should be louder than the others. So you can decide, my opinion's more valid.
Want to plant
the see how that religion, works?
Or screw it, I just adopt the guy who's got the great stuff, right? But let people have the choice and not like, oh, frack, I invested into fate and I don't get absolutely nothing out of it. Especially when I'm a tradition guy with 25 population cities and the guy next to me, who's next to the borders of me with a great religion, never is going to spread the religion to me, though I've got 6,000 fate that I can't fucking use. That's just my opinion on the religion part.
Oh, does it prevent you from buying things with faith and industrial if you don't have a religion?
Yes, it prevents you from buying stuff.
You have to have a religion. No. Fruitstrike, no, that's not quite. Yes, what yours is saying is correct, but it doesn't have to be your religion. It can be someone else's religion.
Joined your channel. Wait, you can't, like, you can't, if you finish tradition, you can't buy engineers if you don't have any religion?
That's correct.
Holy crap, I never knew that. I don't think I've ever not had a religion, whether it was my own or someone else's.
It happened to me sometimes, because sometimes you're like sitting on huge tradition cities somewhere, like, and there's a huge space in between the science leader, and now
correct,
you've
Victor.
Got so much population that the pressure is never enough to convert your cities to a religion
user
without like
your
sending
that's
a missionary
so
or a prophet.
Stupid. Why do you have to have a religion to buy stuff with faith like that? Why can't you just buy, like, if I finish tradition, just let me spend my faith on engineers?
And there's even one more thing that I don't know if you notice, and I happen to notice that. You invest into piety, you finish off piety, and at the finisher it was that you can buy great profits with faith when you finish piety. Now, if you do not get the religion, though, you have piety, and you do enter industrial era, and you can't buy great profits. Even if you do have religion, I believe. I would need to check that out, because...
Wait, I didn't understand that. Could you say that again?
If you don't have a religion and you finish off piety, which allows buy
no piety does not allow buying great profits with faith. It doesn't. All people who have religions can already buy great profits with faith in industrialization. Piety doesn't grant that.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to say. Basically, not okay. You're correct. It doesn't grant, but you can't buy great profits, right? At industrial era, if you don't have religion of your own, basically. So if you've been converted by other players' religion, but you do not have religion of your own, you can't buy great profit in industrial era.
Right.
That's, I don't know if that's fixed or not. I didn't happen to be in a situation like that. It happened to me like a year ago or so. But I remember specifically that I went piety. I had tons of faith, I had tons of cities, but I didn't get the religion, though I was piety, of course. I didn't get a religion, and I couldn't buy damn great profits with faith in the industrial era, though religion
that's
was in those cities.
That's stupid. That is so stupid. You should just, at industrial era, you should just be able to spend your faith on anything that you've unlocked, whether you have a religion or not. I think that, I did not even know that that exists. How do you guys feel about that change happening? Like, I consider that to be a flaw, and I would love to fix it. What do you guys think about that? Where if you don't have a religion, you can still spend your faith if you finished a tree to purchase things of whatever kind, or just to get great profits.
I like it, and I dislike it. As I said, I'm a huge fan of allowing people to get religion, six religions, so it's not limited, so you can't get religion. Now, my reasoning for that is it gives you an option, right? if you see that somebody has a strong religion, better religion than you have, that it's more beneficial for you to acquire the religion from the other guy, then you don't get your own religion. But if you're in a situation that other religions will never get to you, and you will have tons of faith, and if you will not be able to use it on anything, it's just...
Then okay, but Fruitstrike offers a workaround to that. I really disagree with six religions for six players, because it should be a limited resource. I'm fine with faith being spent even if you don't have a religion. That's fine. If you finish tradition and want to purchase engineers and you don't have a religion, I don't give a fuck. That's totally fine.
Well, for that part, I actually don't like it. If you don't have a religion, you buy stuff with faith. It's we're changing. This is still a civilization game, so it should be just a tiny little bit realistic. And for me, realistic thing is that religion is not limited to the number of civilization on the map.
In your mind, it's realistic that when you accumulate enough of faith, which is an intangible quality, that you suddenly accumulate enough of, you can purchase a great scientist. That's realistic to you?
Yeah. Let's keep that part out of there. We're talking about something different right now. What I'm trying to say is...
I agree with you, Lobanez.
Not allowing to get a religion or just not allowing to have that is a little bit strange. And then on the other side, still...
All right, we need to go back.
And you don't have a religion in your cities. Why can you theoretically use that faith? And let's assume buying a great scientist with faith is a miracle, Mr. Filthy. A miracle.
That's what it's supposed to represent. It's supposed to be like you use your faith for that kind of stuff. Real quick, so I've already heard the point about six religions and everything. I have notes on it and everything. So let's not talk about that anymore, because I feel like we're saying the same thing. So,
right.
So let's if you go to the change list, or if you think of anything that you think should be changed, let's look at that stuff. And how about we say, like, what is it, 3:36 here? How about for the next like 9 minutes or so?
All right, let me find it again. This is the note. Okay, Arvius has, by the way, woken up. He's rolled out of bed, put on his fucking Sith hat, and he's ready to be part of this. So he's going to chime in now for these future components, but not so much the social policy parts where we wanted this impact. So, all right. So, for at least for the rest of the changes, right? So, Arvius, can you get a link? Can you find the no quitter? Do you know where the download for the mod is? You can find the change log.
Yeah.
Just go to if you go to the subreddit and click the link on the right. That's the quickest way.
Dead voice.
Do you want to give it to me for a check? It's saving a little time.
No, I'm streaming.
I can do it. You're streaming?
I'm streaming this discussion.
Oh.
With my notes on the page and everything.
Oh, got it. Give me a link to that. I want to tune into that for a second. I want to see the notes on the page.
/Fruitstrike. It's what I name every.
If I don't get a link in Steam, I'm not going there. Just saying.
Oh my god! Really, Princess? Really?
Look, not all of us have a traffic cone at home.
Obvious. I've put the link in TeamSpeak for you.
Oh, cool. Thanks.
Okay. Yeah. So, some things that I don't want to talk about. I don't want to talk about why the Huns are broken. I know they're broken. I don't want to talk about what else. I do want to talk about how you guys feel about the new naval melee ships, new tanks, and if anyone, I'm not sure if anyone has even gotten to rocket artillery yet to test the changes for with no aluminum. Filthy, it's not hard.
I want a link.
Get on your keyboard and type
twitch.tv/fruitstrike. I'm not doing it. That's too much.
Or just press Sid Meier's Civilization 5 on your goddamn main page of your stream.
You've now spent more time telling me about it than linking it to me. Does that not fail?
Typing it to me than just typing the press. Anyway, okay. So I do want to talk about that, because war has changed significantly, and I want to know what you guys think about it, the good parts, the bad parts, etc.
Alright, so how, but what are we doing for format? So I want a section of this later on for general thoughts, because I have some general thoughts that I would like to bring out. But I think in terms of like making this sane, because we're already 2 hours into this, just to go through the list.
Timer, man.
Goddamn right. So let's
eating into your 30 seconds.
Oh, I'm eating my 30 seconds for all of the changes under the units tab? It's like 10 changes.
This is like crazy.
Listen, it doesn't
good.
Matter.
Two pages.
Just go for
two pages.
Go for
next version for, 6. Whoops.
Yeah, don't worry about next
version. All right, Yoruus, let's do 5 minutes total for all the changes. Go through quickly. Don't spend any length of time on any of this. You're just going through all the changes listed on that page. I have a link if you need it. So not counting the social policy. So it starts under
version 5.
Yeah, exactly.
I require.
Go. I'll give you 5 minutes. Go.
Don't worry
now
about
grants 10% okay.
Yoruus, you don't have to read it out loud. We're all literate.
You lost 10 seconds.
Landships, tank panzers, and all that stuff. Never had a chance to check that out, so nothing.
Oh,
to
you gotta
to
try that sometime.
They're amazing.
Yeah, they're amazing.
They do too much land damage.
You've never made it slipping.
God damn it, is my time or not?
Yes, go, Yoruus. Go.
Okay, Yoruus is the only. Filthy, it's your job to smack down people.
All right.
Talk over Yoruus.
First strike, you're talking over Yoruus. Be quiet. Yoruus, go.
Quiet!
Mounted units for mountain unit from range unit. Now, mountain units I like. Keshiks, camel archers, charge archers. I still feel that shooting into pikemen should not be so hard. I need a fix for that part. If you shoot with mounted ranged units, they need to deal the same damage as them crossbows, not like redundancy more or less, because you've got so much percentage boost to the combat strength versus mounted units. Frigates, I don't care about frigates whatsoever. Ships of the lines, I don't care about ships of the lines whatsoever. Infantry requires ballistics instead of plastics. I like that change. A-bombs removes from the game. I have a strange feeling about A-bombs. I'm not a huge fan.
Stronger
of
he gets hit, Manatee. The stronger.
For A-bombs. And I would prefer to actually have A-bombs instead of nuclear missiles, because as it stands right now,
sound you familiar get for sure?
And you have all the units lost there. So
okay,
I would prefer to use.
Let me interrupt you so that you.
I'm
know
pausing Yoruus' this time.
The plan is to do one of two things. Either implement a system that has real cost for using nukes, like massive unhappiness hit or something like that, or the other plan is make a nuclear missile be the exact same thing as an atomic bomb, except still cost the same as a nuclear missile and still come at the same tech. So it doesn't do the damage that a nuclear missile does. It's essentially remove nukes from the game and move atomic bomb up to nuke technology and make it cost the same as nuke, but still have the same effect that an atomic bomb would have. So
whose idea was
that?
That
helps you. That's a couple of possible ideas. I don't remember whose ideas these
are. That's my idea, asshole. Give me credit.
Oh, was it? do you know how many people I talk to and get ideas from? It's like at least 20 regularly, probably 30 more. So anyway, I, of course I don't remember where all the
it was going. From. Sorry, go on. I'm derailing my own thread.
Okay, go ahead, Yoruus.
All right. Stealth bombers require 2 aluminium. I don't bloody care if they require 2 aluminium instead of 1. It's still land base. If you have guaranteed some of the aluminium, the strategic balance, then that's cool. But if you're fracked up on aluminium, will it cost 2 or 1? It absolutely doesn't matter. I like the change 75% evasion, though still I have a feeling that with the balance with jet fighters, I never actually test that out or would test it out, because I don't know if that's air yet. It's really hard to judge. I have a feeling that 75%, this is reduction to the interception damage. With healing promotion, it will not matter whatsoever. Workboat cost reduced by 40%. I tremendously like the change to the workboats, because it was so hard to get the resources in ocean tiles to be actually useful coastal tiles. So I like that change very much. Naval units, I love it. Now there's a slight problem with sieves, actually with one particular sieve. This is Byzantine, which has a replacement range unit. You could have a problem with that. You can fix that, but nothing to be. I like that change very, very much, that they work like a mounted units. Air tank guns and helicopter gunships now have 200% versus armor units. Now I'm just going to quickly look at the tech tree.
It's because when I buffed the tanks, I forgot that the anti-tank and
Yoruus is talking about when they become available, and
yeah,
I'm curious when
no
are they.
Problem. Gotcha. Anti-tank guns come after the tanks, so it's tremendously maybe not tremendously much easier. Yes, it is fucking tremendously much more easier to get tanks than to get a reasonable amount of planes, because if you're going the dynamite route, you get cavalries, so you can upgrade cavalries right into the damn tanks. And if you want to get planes, if you don't have a huge amount of gold and you didn't invest in the commerce or autocrats, you're fucked. You can't defend against tanks if tanks are so boosted. So either move tanks into combined arms or get anti-tanks at railroad, something around those lines, so you can defend against tanks with something and not be steamrolled into with tanks, because anti-tanks come at combined arms, which is tremendous amounts of techs after the damn tanks. That's my opinion.
When yours can't just go on forever, Mr. Okay, Chipsy is much more reasonable.
Rocket artillery no longer requires aluminum. I like it. Giant Death Robot gets interception tree promotion. Okay. Okay, stealth bombers, nothing to add to that. Unit promotions, air repair now needs an extra promotion before it's available. I actually like that change, but I like this change on bombers. I don't like this change on planes. Now, I had a game that I was referring to with Commerce Autocracy, and there was like 10 planes versus 10 planes. It's ridiculous. The planes take so random amount of damage that you can't use intercept. The air combat right now feels a little bit out of balance. I would like to keep healing promotion on fighters at promotion 3, and on bombers, I'm perfectly fine with having it after bombardment 3 or siege 3 or stuff like that. So I would prefer to have air repair on fighters as a third promotion, not as a fourth promotion. Blitz paratroopers and XCOM squads are now paradropping units instead of gunpowder units. Yeah, that was fine. Great people meters, I'm absolutely fine with that. Great scientists, bulb amount, I actually like that. I like that change, but this is another change that keeps the whole science out of balance. There's no point keeping the great scientists, and most of the time there's no point to actually plant the great scientist, because you're probably never going to get 2000 science through the rest of the game with plant a great scientist. This, I like it, but at the same time, I feel the science game is hugely unbalanced. It's absolutely hugely unbalanced. I would be quite happy to remove Great Scientist Bulb mechanic from the game and just allow Great Scientists to work as the other great people and just plant them.
We're going to give them 9 minutes.
I don't know what else to do it, because obviously, like, Research One Tech was removed from the game. It was removed from the game for a reason, so we don't want to get back to that. Technology, change is perfect. Stoneworks, I love the change to Stoneworks. It's great. And East India Trade Company trade route is also tremendously good. I like that change too. Now, oh my goodness, it's one full. Anchor Watt, fine, nothing to talk about that. And Notre Dame change is actually detrimental for me with the change to, I actually don't understand the change, why Notre Dame provides great artist point instead of great merchant point. I don't get that change. Then other wonders should be changed, but yeah. Maybe you can tell me after I'm going to be done. Custom House now receives plus 4 gold at economics. This is ridiculously great. Great merchant plants give right now plus 12 gold at the late after economics, which is tremendously good, especially with commerce. I like that change very much. Social policies, we talked about. Tourism. Tourism is out of balance totally. Not getting faith from religious city-states, I like. Pantheons. Keeps the Fate game out of balance very, very much right now.
We're going to talk about Pantheons after, so just ignore that for now.
Yeah, and Great Profits. This is a very nice change to reduce the RNG slightly. This is cool. And what else to say? Yeah, there's basically nothing more.
Okay.
Eldorado change, cool. Radaring removed from the game. Awesome.
All right, Arvius, you ready? Give yours, Arvius, did you die? Did you go back to sleep? Useless fuck.
Okay, Filthy, go ahead.
Alright, I'm gonna give myself 9 minutes just like I gave yours 9.
Was that really 9 minutes?
Yep, it was.
Holy crap.
Alright, Iroquois bonus is good stuff. Tank stuff, I still have not been able to test tanks because my games refuse to go past the artillery era anymore. I kind of like Yoruus's points about it. The thing is, tanks can be upgraded, whereas bombers can't, so that the the counter to tanks have to be hard built while the tanks themselves don't. I'm not sure how I feel about that. I like the idea that tanks are boosted, but perhaps it may not need to be quite as strong as this. But I don't actually fucking know because I can't get there because all the games end in artillery. Chariot archers and horse archers being actually mounted units are fucking fantastic. Although it does make Spearmen fairly strong. I second Yoruus' issue with it being very hard to push into pikemen, especially fortified pikemen. Perhaps pikemen could have either a reduced bonus on defense or no bonus on defense as opposed to bonuses on offense. So then like pikemen counter camels by attacking them, but they don't counter them by just standing there. Frigates need to be unnerfed.
Pause the timer real quick. Just so you guys know, Lancer does upgrade into anti-tank gun. So the anti-tank gun does have something that upgrades into it.
We're talking about bombers
and ballistics.
I thought you said that anti-tank doesn't have anything that upgrades into it.
Sure, bombers is an anti-tank, but anyways, go on. I'll go on.
Right. Okay.
We'll get there.
Go ahead.
All right. I think frigates need to be unnerfed. They are already so far out of the tech path that they are a huge pain in the ass. Currently, this nerf doesn't do anything to protect cities that are, like, island cities are still fucked by frigates because so many frigates can get in there, but it now makes it extremely difficult to take inland cities at all because frigates aren't strong enough versus crossbows and particularly Gatling guns. So frigates do not do the job of removing cities that are important anymore. I don't think that nerf needs to be there. I think Ship of the Line still needed a slight nerf relative to frigates, but they need to be stronger than frigates, but not that much stronger, just like all the fucking unique units. Infantry, I love that change. Atomic bombs, we've already heard my idea. My idea is to remove atomic bombs, remove nuclear missiles entirely and put atomic bombs in the nuclear missile spot in terms of tech, and also to up the cost of atomic bombs to nuclear missile cost.
It was you with that idea. Oh.
Don't worry about it, Fruitstrike. Get back on your cone and be quiet.
Okay, all right. Let's keep going.
Moving on. Stealth bombers, I don't really care if they have two aluminum or one. I think stealth bombers, I don't think the problem is that they cost too much strategic resources. I think the problem is they have no fucking counter. 75% evasion down from 100%, I don't think this actually fixes anything. There's still, you can still just slam stealth bombers into whatever target you want. The interception mechanic already is pretty bad in the sense that you cannot protect units with interception particularly well versus bombers if there's enough bomb, if you just slam them in anyway. So my thought on this is remove evasion entirely from stealth bombers. It shouldn't be there, or if it is there, it should be a promotion people have to choose and take. Workboats, I don't even know why it's reduced by 40%. I thought we thought about 50%. I think workboats as in themselves are extraordinarily weak, so buffing them is really good for the game, and more buffs is better for workboats. Naval melee, that's totally fine. It hasn't done anything to negatively impact the game to me. I think it's good. Anti-tank guns and helicopter gunships. Anti-tank guns need to be available at a time they can actually counter tanks. If they're later in the tech tree, all the counters being later in the tech tree than the military tech that it is in themselves is useless. So if we're going to be building a unit that sucks versus everything except tanks, but it's good versus tanks, it's not very good if you build that after tanks. You need to be building that when people attack you with tanks, not when it doesn't fucking do anything. Rocket artillery, that was my idea. I really liked that idea. Giant death robots, start with interception, fine. I don't think anyone's ever built a giant death robot that wasn't trolling, so whatever. Air repair, I think that's good. It has changed the face of air games. I like the idea that air repair comes much later. It makes bombers a lot weaker. I don't know how this interacts with tanks yet because I haven't played it, but if bombers are a hell of a lot weaker, tanks are a hell of a lot better, I can imagine there being some potential problems there, but I don't know because I've never got past artillery. Blitz being removed, of course, is great. Great people meters is really, really cool. Although there are a shit ton of engineers out there right now, and that means a lot of wonders.
I'm one of them.
There's a shit ton of great engineers out there, so that means that wonders are getting great engineered a lot more than they were before, and I don't know how I feel about that overall. I had the thought the other day that it might be good if great engineers started at 134 instead of 67 for their base cost. That being so that the engineers aren't coming out quite as quickly as they were before, although still unlinking the great scientists. I like great scientists bulbing right now. I hadn't thought about Yoruus's point that it may be better always to bulb now as opposed to plant, but I like the fact that you don't hoard great scientists. That's much better for the game. Compass buff is good. Stoneworks buff is good. The East India buff is good. Anchor Wat buff is good. I don't understand why Notre Dame gives artist points. I assume you did that for some bizarre form of like realism, but I don't like balancing games based on realism, fuck that.
Let me say it real quick then, since both of you brought it up. It's because Notre Dame gives you happiness. Why does it give you a random merc? It doesn't make sense. Artists also give you happiness, meaning like
because it's a church, right? Notre Dame is a church, right?
Yeah, but what I'm saying
because
is
it
like,
fleeces the people who walk into it. Done. Merchant points.
You double up. Well, I mean, it's also very artistic. It makes sense whether it's artist or merchant. But the reason I picked artist is because it makes sense from a you use artists to get golden ages, which are something that's related to happiness. Happiness also gives you golden ages. It makes so much more sense.
Doesn't Chitsunetsu give you engineer points?
Yeah, that's the other thing is I think that there needs to be more. This was a test to try it out to see because there's nothing that gives you great artist engineer. I'm sorry, artist, musician, or what's
Fruit
it? Writer points. So
nobody
that was a
cares
test.
About outgrade person points from wonders except engineers and scientists. So
that's the whole point, though.
They
he's trying to
more.
Make it so they do.
I was trying this out as a test of what is it like when you can actually get artist and I keep saying engineer, writer and musician points from wonders as well, because that's something that can potentially help with the culture game, possibly also the tourism game. Who knows?
All right, well, like, okay. If I'm just weighing in on my opinion, I don't think that changes influential one way or the other. I don't care.
Right.
Customs House. I still don't plant great merchants because it's still much better to use them for influence and gold immediately. So we either need some more changes to Custom House to make it worth planting, or we just have to deal with the fact that we're still using them under city-states every single time. Tourism needs a buff, period, right now. So any buffs that have been previously applied to tourism weren't enough. City-state religion no longer, city-state no longer giving faith is really, really good for the game. It makes it a lot less RNG-oriented. The pantheons we're going to talk about later. The Great Prophet RNG, I initially was really, really pleased with that, and I've since come a total 180 on that, and I've gone back to the fact that I prefer the RNG because it mixes up who gets first religion, which I like. I don't, and possibly because of the fucking piety shit right now. Like, it shouldn't just be because you had first pantheon that you get first religion. It should be because you're generating more faith. And right now, the way that the Prophet RNG, the change to the Prophet RNG actually gives bonuses to people who had first faith as opposed to most faith, whereas I think most faith should be the one driving the religion. So for example, if you have a pantheon that takes a minute to improve, like Corey
saying.
Faith, okay, you understand what I'm saying, cool. Research agreements being removed is good. Barb Camp Ruins being removed is good, although we just had a bug recently where I was playing in a six-way game, everyone had the mod, everyone had the map, someone picked up a rune, it told them it was a Barb Camp Rune, and then it crashed the game afterwards. So that's something that needs to be fixed.
Yeah, I heard about that. I have to find out why it's doing this.
Yep, map rune thing is amazing. I love the new map runes. They're actually not terrible. You're like, map rune, okay, I'm a little disappointed. It's not a pop rune or a culture rune, but it does some fucking total garbage right now. That's good. Eldorado change is great. Radaring change is surprisingly, I surprisingly hate it because I'm so used to radaring, but I'm not convinced it isn't good for the game. I just kind of dislike it right now based on personal experience. I think that's it, right? All right, Arvius?
Can I have like 2 minutes?
No one invited you, Cole. I'm totally joking. Of course. Just what did you want to talk about? Like, instead of... So I want to change the format real quick. Instead of going through the whole list, don't say things out loud. I'm okay. Just scan the list and just say things that you're not okay with.
No, it's kind of important to talk about that because I think it's going to be good for the people listening to hear people say, we like this change or don't like this change. So I don't agree with that for sure.
I guess.
Mine is regarding promotions on bombers. I mentioned this to you before. Anti-tank one or the anti-armored promotion. I'd like that to be its.
Thanks so much, Seven.
It brought down to a level one promotion where you don't need the other ones to get into it.
Same with naval.
And the same thing with naval. And add air repair at the end of those three tiers of promotions.
So let me clarify, brother Fruitstrike, do you know what Cole's saying?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Okay. I don't need to clarify then. You got what he's saying?
Yep.
All right, cool. Arvius, you want to go through the list? Are you not here again still?
Okay. Workboats, cool. That one promotion, haven't seen it in action. As far as anti-tank guns, same thing coming earlier. There's a serious problem, though. We can't just do, like, 200% for anti-tank guns, 100% for land promotions, because... I'll just throw out a couple examples. Bazookas, what do you do with bazookas? Are you going to use bazookas ever? No. So I think that needs to be nerfed. The tank damage needs to be nerfed. And as far as bombers go, making air promotion go to like after bombardment 3 is good, but it also causes problems because of tanks. Like right now, what do you do? What like you can't really deal with these like massive amounts of tanks. So there's an issue. Aluminum, not on rocket artillery, that's fine. I'm not sure about the giant death robots giving interception. Personally, I just think they need like reduced damage to bombers or something, but who knows? Maybe an interception's good too.
Okay.
If we're like nerfing like evasion and whatnot. East India, great. Notre Dame, it doesn't really matter. I think they should yield more points though, but that's just me. Custom houses, same thing with what Filthy said. Like they just don't yield enough. Compass is great. And aside from that, I'm seeing like, if unless I'm looking at a different link, I see like all these social policies. Like, I don't know where the rest of what you guys were referring to are on this list.
Let me give you a link to what I'm referencing right now.
You're at the right place. Yeah, you got the custom house, and after the social policies, you have tourism, city states, etc. That goes.
Alright, I hate to do this for the fucking the sake of the format. I fucking hate to do this, but I really wanted Arvius to chime in on the social policy balances. Anyone gonna mind if he goes through them? You up for that, first strike?
I'm fine with that. I mean, let me open them again on my stream.
You gonna be up for that, Arvius?
Yes, I would love to talk about that.
Alright, so...
Should I go through this unit list, though? I was actually looking at a different one.
Yeah, keep finishing the list.
Okay, as far as atomic bombs and nuclear missiles go, I think I like the idea that you're saying, Filthy, but I think you should have the option to build both. Just have them, like, cost the same or something, but they're kind of, like, doing the same effects. Maybe leave the two range of nuclear missiles, I don't know, but you should be able to... You can't load an atomic bomb on a nuclear sub, you know what I mean?
So, okay, but so the part that we want to change about nuclear missiles is we think it's current, or I think, from my idea, what I hate about nuclear missiles, I think it's really dumb that it kills all units within a 2-tile radius. I don't mind that it damages, like an atomic bomb has a chance to damage, it kills the target it hits and damages everything around it. I like that. That basically wipes the army out without killing every single unit. The problem with Civ is it's related to hexes, right? You can't stack up a million units without clustering in a big fucking group. There's no way to do it. So a nuclear missile basically wipes out way more production than its value is worth. And that's what I don't like about them. So what part of that did you want? You just want them to be able to be loaded on carriers still and on subs, or do you want them, or do you actually, okay. So you just want the applicability to deploying them. I got you.
Yeah,
so really,
one-shotting is ridiculous.
Okay, so you'd be okay with A-bombs replacing nuclear missiles for everything, and then basically all the things that could carry nuclear missiles before being able to carry A-bombs.
Yes.
Gotcha. Go on.
Okay, so let's see here.
Can I interrupt one second?
Sure.
Dear God.
I just want to talk about atomic bombs one more thing. So with the change to bulbing, it makes Hubble extremely strong. Like way stronger than it's ever been. And currently if someone gets Hubble, they can just bulb up to nuclear missiles and nuke people before they even have a chance of being close to bomb shelters.
I haven't found that to be an issue. I feel by the time people get to nuclear missiles, I can get to bomb shelters.
Not with Hubble, in my experience.
And I've also found that if I get nuclear missiles once or twice, I can still win games.
That depends on if you're playing Liberty or Tradition.
Okay, so yeah, Hubble... It's a little bit stronger than before, I can agree on that, but
I think it needs a nerf.
I don't think it's that. Wouldn't you just nerf Great Scientist bulbing or something?
Something of the
sort. Well, anyway, okay. Point is taken. Let's move on to something else now. I totally get it. I have it written down and everything. But let's go to something else.
All right, so Arvius, do the social policies. We just basically went through, you're going to do this all on your own without any breaks, so good luck. But we went through basically all of the social policies, not counting exploration. So, go.
Okay.
You might want to pull up the Civ game if you don't have it open already.
You can just click the links in the docs.
That works. Yeah, I'm trying to look at the links right now. So we're going through every single one, like Tradition, Liberty, Honor, Piety, and so on.
Yep, Tradition, Liberty, Honor, Piety, yes, Patronage, sir. Aesthetics, Commerce, Rationalism.
Oh boy, haven't had any thought about this. Okay, so Tradition...
Do you want to do it a different time? Do you want to think about it?
No.
I can just talk to you separately?
I can just look at it and think about it right now.
Okay.
I think, but I haven't heard any of what you guys are thinking about it. So
yes, we all wish you'd been here 2 hours ago, too.
Yeah, I know. So whatever you guys may have said may have illuminated some points that I may have not realized or realized or whatever.
If you want to look at my stream, I have my notes on the screen of just generally what people have said. I mean,
yeah. Could you provide a link for that, Fruitstrike?
Note taking, but what's that?
Could you provide a link for your stream? I'd like a look at that.
Do it in your
I'm
chat.
I'm gonna link it to you. So you're horrible.
Such a
There we go. I linked it to your chat so that they'll punish you for your laziness and come to my
there
stream
you go,
instead
filthy.
Of yours.
God.
Thank you, guys. I really appreciate that.
Honestly, I don't have a whole lot to say about most of them. Maybe I would have a lot to say about what people would, in response to what people would say, and whatnot, like proposed changes or what they feel about it. But
open.
All right. How about this then? How about this, Arvius? Since you weren't here for the discussion, it's too bad because I would have liked to hear your thoughts on the discussion we had, because we had a pretty good discussion about it. Rather than do that, rather than try to make changes, don't worry about making changes. Just talk about if you think they're good as is, need buffing, or are too strong right now. Okay.
Okay, so Liberty, I think it's pretty good right now. I don't really have any problems with Liberty. I think it's pretty competitive. As far as Piety goes, I can't really give much opinion on that until, Reformation beliefs are changed and whatnot. Because I don't think that a full Piety opener is viable yet. Because it's too reliant on getting pagodas or stuff like that.
Okay, one of the hot topics was regarding the two faith in the opener and having only four religions with six players. Do you have anything to weigh in on that? Or
okay, if the two faith is too much, in which allows for the pantheon grab, which then allows for the immediate faith income, which then leads to the first religion going, which is pretty much pagodas. Sure, you could nerf the faith, but you're gonna have to boost the culture.
Yeah. One thing I was—I actually do want to get your opinion on this real quick. One thing I was considering is making it so that none of the follower beliefs that anyone can get, regardless of whether you go piety, have two happiness in them. Like pagodas and temples were reduced to one happiness, maybe buffed another way, maybe not, whatever. And then just have those kind of things only in Reformation, so that you're forced to. Go piety for like the best benefits, but everyone can still get benefits from religion. What do you think of that?
Well, what would my Reformation belief be? Like, get pagodas would be my Reformation belief?
I don't know. Like, just make a new, like, you know, like a different kind of building. You know, the madrasa is now a religious building you can get via Reformation belief, and it gives you two happiness and, you know, whatever else.
Yeah, maybe, but couldn't we just make some other of the religious beliefs better? Or maybe you want to nerf pagodas, but cathedrals, really? A cathedral's half a pagoda? Are you kidding me?
No. I wouldn't be changing anything that has more. That has. I'm only changing the things that have plus two happiness, because the difference between plus one and plus two is huge.
Per city. Why don't you just make more buildings?
Yeah, I can do that too.
No, you could do that. All right, we're getting derailed as fuck on this. Let Arvius talk.
A little bit. Thank you, Judge Filthy on duty. All right. So, I meant that complimentary, by the way, Filthy. Go ahead, Arvius, and whatever else you want to talk about for those trees.
Okay. So piety, like I said, there's major issues because of like what you can pick from religion and what you can do with Reformation. You can't do shit with Reformation right now except Jesuit education and Great Person Purchasing. So until changes are done to that, piety has a problem as far as the initial faith grab. The only way you can fix the opener is adding culture to it or doing something in like an initial policy, like the policy after the opener, to like make it a little bit better.
Which one were you just talking about just now?
Piety
I think
opener.
Something just... Okay, all right.
Because if you had a little more culture, you could pick up, let's say, Mandate of Heaven to stop people from just opening up piety and getting some pantheon to avoid building a shrine and planting cities on gems or something like that.
Okay.
As far as honor goes, there's...
Can I add something in real quick about piety? One second.
Oh, okay. No, you can't, Slipping! Really no!
Since if you guys were talking about cutting religions down from 6 to 4, what would you guys think
there's
about...
There's not... Like, what do you mean 6 to 4? It's already 4.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, it's going to 6. I'm saying, like, what would you guys think about the requirement that you have to open piety to get a religion?
I think that's a terrible idea. Next.
Why?
Because it shouldn't... It's a fucking mechanic. No, I'm dead serious. Like, it's a terrible idea. Religion is not supposed to be... It's not supposed to be you pick a policy tree, you get a religion. That's not how it's supposed to be.
No,
it's supposed to be...
the whole point about getting it. It's just saying that you can't get it without it. It's saying that if you want to invest in the game and actually having some sort of piety, you get the ability to get a religion. It doesn't mean you get one automatically. It doesn't mean that, you know, you're guaranteed it. It's just meaning that you have to actually spend one policy to get a religion because it's such a huge bonus.
Yeah, let's pretend you have to spend one policy to get science and one policy to get culture, one policy to build military units, one policy to expand, and suddenly it's fucking useless. It's not. It removes options.
I have a solution, guys.
I am throwing down the gauntlet right now.
But I have a great idea.
Right, no one can talk. Okay, so listen. Thank you for the suggestion. Let's get back to what we were doing real quick, and then we can talk about it more afterwards. Let's just let Arvius get through his stuff, then we'll get to other people getting through their stuff, etc. Okay?
Well, hold on. It won't take long. It'll take me 15 seconds.
No, Cole.
I'm going to do it anyways. All right, so my idea would be, why don't you just buff piety, but move it to the same, that it's the same level as patronage when that you can add.
So move piety to classical. Thank you for suggestion. Arvius, go ahead.
Bad idea, Cole. I have to respond to this. So
this is why we should remember. Remember when everyone was laughing at me?
Lock piety or religions into only getting piety. The only thing you should be doing here is buffing the religions of piety, either Reformation or something else.
Exactly.
That's terrible. That's absolutely 100%. Terrible. So I guess I was going to go into talking about honor.
Okay. Remember when I was sitting here discussing we should have 3 minutes and 30 seconds? Do you know why? Because I wanted to avoid what's going on right now.
Like losing production because you have two.
Who is right? Who was fucking right?
Extreme.
Oh,
you just
okay.
Have no ability to expand, and you can't. You have no ability to do very much about it. It needs to be like increased or remove civilian units from the equation.
Okay.
I thought we're gonna, at the end of this, we were going to do a part where we just talked about general changes, and that's one of the general changes I advocate too, is I don't think unit cap does anything good for the game.
Okay. As far as everything else...
That's right, Zira.
I'm not sure about adding more free maintenance from units. I think honor is actually pretty good where it's at. I know it yields more happiness from other trees, but I don't know. I needed to test it more. I haven't been able to test it too much. Patronage. I'm sure.
Do you want to do tradition before you move on to that?
Say what?
Do you want to touch tradition before you go on to that so we finish the opening policies?
I'm not sure what to do with tradition. What did you guys suggest?
No, just what were your thoughts? I mean, we're not going to reiterate. So just
about
you,
tradition. Yeah. I think it's fine because of how well it. Allows for the growth, which allows for you to do. It allows for easy openings into patronage as an aesthetics, and rationalism. Like it complements all this like great person spamming and working slots and everything about the other trees. But it's not like liberty full on complements piety, for example.
Yeah. Patronage.
Patronage. So
user disconnected from your channel.
I think it should be one influence instead of two influence for city-states, for the trade routes, because that way you're not losing influence, but you're not necessarily freely gaining influence either.
That's unanimous, by the way.
Like it.
Stop interrupting, Filthy.
I haven't tested this, so I can't really give a hard-on opinion on of this.
You really just said that.
Give him a cone.
Yeah, he just said the word hard-on.
Rod, wrong phrase.
I'm not
phrasing.
Gonna lie.
Okay. A hard
that
formula,
was really difficult for
opinion.
Me not to say some kind of joke about that. I just wanted to point it out.
Okay,
keep going.
All right,
didn't you just yell at someone for interrupting? Sorry, go on.
Hey, I said I have the privilege
Man,
of doing that.
Shut up. Let Arvius speak. Go, shoot.
Like I said, it's hard to say stuff when I haven't tested some of these. So I think the science might be a bit extreme, but I haven't tested it.
Has anybody actually finished patronage?
I have.
Do you know the 50% bonus works?
Does it work?
Yes.
Yeah, because I noticed like certain times it was not working.
It works.
It definitely works. Yeah, it's been tested a bunch. It only affects food, faith, and culture. Okay, Arvius?
Okay, as far as that goes, that's all I can say about that. As far as commerce is, mercenary army, I've said this before, I think it shouldn't be a first policy. I think that's a little bit early. Aside from that, I don't think it's necessarily weak. I heard a lot of people saying that it's weak. Maybe protectionism is a little bit silly. Like, am I really going to want to be spending 80 hammers to invest for 3 gold from my harbor and caravansary? Maybe. But should I really have to build worthless buildings just so I can get the use of this policy? I think not. I think that needs to be reworked.
Okay. Do you think it needs to be lower?
No, I think it needs to be something else entirely. Something that, like gold from markets. How about that? Something that I already have. Something that I don't have to build a fucking caravansary for just getting gold off of it, you know?
Okay.
I could add in into that.
The happiness is fine for...
You could add in other policies, basically commerce opener could be 25% decrease in hammers required to crank out markets, stock exchanges, caravanseries, harbors, for example.
Okay, but I still don't want to build a caravansary so I can get use out of perfectionism when I have no use of building a caravansary.
But you do, as commerce, have use to build
you
a caravansary.
You do want to build caravansary because adds up gold to the caravans you're sending, so...
Okay, but every single city, I'm going to want to build it in there. Yeah. That's ridiculous. Yeah.
That's a good point.
You want to build it.
No, I agree with Arvius there. It's a good point that you're not...
policy tree, read it, and then go pull up aesthetics and look at every single one there. And like every single one has a use. Every single... Why do we have this policy that is completely worthless, pretty much?
Fuck. Right back. AFK. One moment.
Happiness.
Coastal empires with harbors. And the happiness, that's a second... Circus Maximus right there.
Okay, go on.
It's still bad.
Okay,
I like
so...
it. Go on.
Let me pull up aesthetics. Let's see here. I still don't like the free policy from the finisher. I think that needs to be something else entirely. I just don't like the idea of getting a free policy from aesthetics because it allows people to get all this culture generation and like double or like all, I wouldn't say quite triple, but at least double their current culture yields, which allows for opening up stuff into like ideologies and whatnot or whatever. So I don't think it needs to have a free social policy. It needs to have something else. And I don't know what something else would be right now. Maybe something geared towards tourism. Maybe not.
Okay.
Rationalism, opening that up. I think the 17% science from universities, or maybe not secularism, but one of those needs to be bumped up. You shouldn't have to pick up... I guess you can go free thought into humanism. Is that something you can do?
Yes. You can get humanism as third policy.
Okay, well... I think scientific revolution should be moved over, like taking humanism's position or something. I think you just don't have enough benefits from opening up into rationalism. I know the idea was to nerf it and nerf the, like, forcing you to go into it because of how driving science is in the game, but maybe it's a little bit, like, once science from trading posts, that can be good if you have enough trading posts, but it's not... It's a lot of junk until like crazy strong stuff towards the very end.
So one of the ideas that have been being passed around is removing direct science bonuses entirely and buffing things like production towards science buildings or spies or other things that indirectly affect science but aren't directly affecting science. Things like the policy towards great great scientist generation or gold from science buildings. All these things are kind of interesting things that are good, but aren't as powerful as that. Do you have any thoughts on that kind of buff?
So, like, removing secularism is what you're saying.
Yep, and humanism.
So would I have, like, a free spy or something? Or is, like, 100%...
That's a possibility.
...percent production towards, like, all things that relate towards getting a national intelligence agency? Maybe I have an increased chance of stealing a tech? Because, I don't know. Or no, increased chance of being successful and not getting caught. Because your spies are rational. I don't know.
I want to add up a little bit to this because over all the changes, I think all the changes right now are focusing only on war. Now, if all those changes right now does not benefit science victory in any way, shape, or form.
Yeah.
I haven't seen a science victory in the modern game just yet. I've seen culture victory. I've seen total war domination victory. I haven't seen Turin's victory, and I haven't seen science victory. It feels like all the changes right now does not allow you to go science victory reliably or Turin's victory at the same time, too.
I did it.
Great. Well, it's pretty hard because towards the information era, you're not really building infrastructure. You're just spamming units, so it just really gears the game to a do or die sort of situation.
Yeah.
So without extensive bulbing and even building the space bars before, if you decide to build space bars, you're gonna get nuked and killed in most circumstances.
Yep. The nerfing so I don't know how scientists you do it. Is what killed science victory.
Say again, Zemt?
The nerfing of the scientist bulbing is kind of just killed science victory.
Which is fucking great for the game.
I agree.
Not the science victory being done, but the scientists, yeah.
Yeah, this is great, but still, like, the mod seems like it turns down Civ still to only war, and...
Okay, then make it rationalism only, and let's say, like, what if you could just start building all of the space parts if when you finished rationalism? And you unlock Apollo program.
Well, one idea, one idea was...
Completely serious.
Actually, two different ideas were having the finisher to either let you buy spaceship parts with faith or giving, like, a double production boost to spaceship parts, things like that. But you know what else it is? It's the fact is where the spaceship parts are in the tree as well. It's just too hard to get to them.
Can I interject this for a second?
Go on.
I don't hear a no. I don't think any policy that isn't an ideology should have anything really to do with victory conditions. I think those should be limited to ideologies only.
I think that's actually impossible because domination victory is going to be related to military units, and that
which is currently only honor.
Well, you could say it's also commerce. You know, you could say it's also everything leads to military units. I think that I understand what you're saying. I could see reasoning for that for science victory because, you know, why are we thinking about spaceships in the Renaissance? But why not? I don't know. But
no, I'm gonna gently that until, like, atomic or modern.
I want to gently but loudly push us back towards kind of the goal here again, which is to get all the opinions from different people out there without debating it quite yet. So let's not debate those. Let's hear the thoughts that people are presenting and move on to the next thing.
Okay, let me write that down.
All right, so Pantheon's next, and then I want to leave a portion of the time at the end of this to talk about just general thoughts and ideas about the mod in general from each of the perspectives being discussed here, but I don't want to do that quite yet. So let's do Pantheon's next, yeah?
Do I need to take another coffee or something?
You can go first.
Talking about the trees.
All right, where do we find Pantheon's, like, a list? Where's the easiest way to see a list? On the link off of Fruitstrike stuff, right?
There was one in Reddit.
I could share that spreadsheet, Fruity, if you want me to.
Oh, I got it. I got
here,
his stuff.
Yeah. I put the link in the...
All right. This is the V5 so, changes. I got that.
Do I need to go to all the Pantheon?
No, that's the Pantheon list version 5. Do you want the version 5 changes?
No.
Where'd you link this, Fruitstrike?
In the TeamSpeak. All right.
Do you not want me to link the other one, Fruity? Because I like that
no.
one a lot better.
This is fine.
Don't
Okay, I'm gonna start off.
Okay.
Ancestor Worship, plastic culture from shrine, useless right now.
Actually, yes. No, never mind. That's a good idea. Let's link that one. Click the one that slipping does, because I'll open it too. Let me find it.
I like this one a lot better when looking at this list.
It's gonna be nicer. Can you link it in your?
It's in TeamSpeak. I just put it in the chat.
TeamSpeak. Right, find it.
One second, I need to find it for me too.
Yeah, I got it. Daughter of Alas, on you and Twitter.
Doesn't want to link.
And Unchanged, we're gonna leave. Alright. Daughter of Autumn, plus one food and plus one production. I feel it's too strong. Especially with randomness on the maps sometimes. If you get tons of plantations, that's just ridiculous.
Did you say it was too strong? That's what you said?
Yes, I said it's too strong. Well, basically, Pantheons, I have a problem basically with Pantheons that give production and food. I feel like Pantheons should be limited to fate, culture, basically. I don't like food and hammers because sometimes the map will just make those Pantheons too strong. I had a game, well, for example, it's actually not connected to this, what I actually said, because like Forest Pantheon, for example, I had a game, Iroquois, tons of forest, all the changes to Iroquois plus Forest Pantheon.
Yoruus, can I interrupt just for half a second? I don't want to take it. What kind of time period are we doing for these guys, for the Pantheon changes?
I need to start wrapping this up relatively soon, so we should go fast. Like, I it's been 3 hours now, so I'm kind of
getting to the... Let's do 5 minutes total.
All right, okay. Let's go. I'm gonna just finish on the Iroquois game. That went absolutely out of hand, but that's just map RNG as usual. Gifts of wisdom, plus one science and plus one faith for each cocoa. When will you get cocos, like enough cocos when you actually use that efficiently? Don't really like that. Culture and faith for each silk and cotton. Same goes. Faith from forest styles. This one Pantheon is hugely overpowered if you do roll sieves like Kells, or you roll sieves like... Well, Kells maybe not, but this is tremendously overpowered if you get good land for Iroquois. Faith from forest styles. Plus the faith from deer. Fine culture for each dice, useless. Plus one fate for each horses, deer, ivory, fur, and bison. This one Pantheon is overpowered a lot as well. Plus one fate and plus one gold from city connections I like, though the other Pantheons would need a little bit of balance to do that. And same goes for one culture and plus one fate for each sugar and spice. That also seems a little bit detrimental because most of the time you actually do not want to work sugar or spice. Those are tiles for the later game, maybe. Tweaked culture from shrines. I don't care about culture from shrines. Absolutely. It doesn't scale well with other Pantheons at all. Tundra tiles, yeah, that's situational as usual. Sometimes could be good, sometimes it's just bad. That's land dependent. Fertility rights plus 20% faster growth, excess food, and one happiness from series population of 10 seems reasonable, but the 20% boost to food seems a little bit overpowered. I think it's too much. Then we go to production in every city. That's good. I actually like the change. It doesn't require the population of 3 to actually make it useful. God of the Sea. Don't like the plus one faith addition to that. God of War seems a little bit overpowered. Seems tremendously overpowered, actually. God of War. God King. Is it tweaked at all?
It is a little. It
doesn't. A little. What does it change?
Happiness.
Happiness. Okay, then I like it. Goddess of Love, tweaked 4+, relatively okay. 50% increase in range combat strength and plus 2 faith from walls. Actually, this is the Pantheon I tremendously like. Okay, Monument of Gods, fine. Culture from plantations. Well, the rest, basically my overall feeling about the Pantheons is either you get the faith pantheon and you get the religion.
Zero's tracking my beers.
Other pantheons will not matter.
Sorry,
you can't
Mom.
Reliably get religion or even get a boost from religion from like faith or other cool stuff. So I'd say like, what's the idea about the pantheons? I would prefer it to be faith and culture generation instead of boosting things like food or hammers or any related stuff that influence basically the echo part of the game, not the religion game, basically. Okay, I'm done.
All right, I'll go next. All right, I really like production and growth pantheons. I really like them because I think they are a nice, they're an opposite. I don't think production or food should be combined with faith. I think it should be an either or. And this is where I really think piety could grow as an opener policy. I think piety could use pantheons as growth and production, whereas liberty or tradition or honor use other things for growth and production, and then still have the faith provided from some other portion of that, preferably a boost to pantheons in general for people opening piety. So the piety pantheons give whatever the base pantheon is plus some degree of faith from the piety portion of it. And this would allow piety to use that as growth and production and then allow you to still have SimCity in those and that type of stuff. So I really,
Where would you put that in the tree, by the way?
It would be an opener. So it would be, instead of getting faith from piety for opening piety, you get faith from pantheons as piety, and therefore you can choose to take production or growth pantheons or faith pantheons, and then you get first religion, but the trade-off is you don't get the production and growth you might otherwise get, and then makes your SimCity worse. So what I like about the production stuff is these are either short-term benefits that get overridden by other people's religions because you can't get a religion, or you have to build Stonehenge, which needs to be untied from piety, or you open piety, and then you get the bonuses to faith to your pantheon already, so that you get that as an alternative. And that said, the individual ones, I think in general, they're almost all balanced. I don't care about 99% of them. The ones that do bother me a little bit, I think God of War is a little bit overpowered. I've used it a couple times now. It seems extraordinarily strong. I think the ones that mix, I don't think there are any in here right now that I can see, just a quick scan. I haven't used...
What do you mean by mix?
The ones that mix faith and production or food. I think you have
only
to be really careful with that.
See.
Okay, it's got to be careful with that. It's tied to workboats, and workboats are very weak, but you're thinking of buffing workboats, so it might not be weak. I don't know. I've heard the forest one's a little overpowered. I haven't used it myself, so I don't know. Desert Faith needs to be tuned down. It's too powerful as it is. But other than that, the other thing I would like you to kind of think about standardizing across the board for pantheons is stuff that requires improvements versus not requiring improvements. If it requires, so for example, God of Tears or whatever the fuck it is, Tears of the Gods, where you get faith from gems or pearls, compare that to Quarry Faith, right? And you are suddenly very, very, very sad because the one requires you spend about 6 turns with a worker that you have to have built a worker to actually get 2 faith from, and one just gives you 2 faith right away. So I feel like you need one of 2 things. You either need to go, all right, the ones that give you, that require improvements, give more yields but have to be improved, which is a pretty reasonable thing. Or you go to the thing, or rather, the combination of that is the ones that require improvement give you better yields but require improvement versus the ones that give you raw bonuses right away but don't require improvements, and that's less of a bonus. So that's my kind of thoughts in general on pantheons.
One thing as well, just to add real quick to that, is just the, when you were saying the comparisons, like if you compare something like +1 faith for forest tiles versus like +1 faith for tundra tiles, the fact that you're generally in a more shitty land if you have tundra tiles, like there should be some sort of balance given that you're trying to boost something that's worse off than something that's fairly common for everybody else.
Arvius, you want to go?
Sure. Okay, so what else? Start off with 2 things before I talk about any specifics of the pantheons. So what I feel is pantheons should have immediate value, and if they don't have immediate value, for example, improving a quarry, improving a plantation, they should be stronger. So, and like if it's not, you need the immediate faith to actually get that religion. So if you're not picking something strong, you're not getting the first or second religion, and most likely you're, if you pick up something like Daughter of Autumn, it's just going to be fucking useless. So you're going to get overtaken eventually. And you still have to improve the plantations in the first place. So as far as Daughter of Autumn goes, I think it's absolutely fine. You compare that to Sun God. Sun God is immediate. And if you think about it, what's a sugar tile? Sugar tile is 3 food, 1 hammer, and like 3 gold or something with that Daughter of Autumn. So it's like 2 gold more than a salt tile or something, or 1 less hammer. So it's really not that crazy, and you still have to improve it. And I agree with the point with Tears of the Gods, but then you have an issue with gems, or not with gems, with pearls. You don't, You have to put a workboat on it to actually work it, because you're not going to work at one food, two golds, two faith tile. Or I guess if you get a lighthouse, it's so slow for pearls. So I don't know what you're going to do with that.
It could just be one faith from gems and two faith from pearls. Actually, you get the faith from pearls immediately, but you don't have to have a workboat.
Yeah, but Arvius's point is you're never going to work pearls on its own.
Right, yeah.
So yeah. I guess a way to look at that is you're going to work mining resources, you're going to work growth resources, you're not going to work shitty tiles like fucking silk or pearls, you know?
Yeah, okay.
As far as silk and cotton goes, I have yet to have a game where I've had silk and cotton. It's pretty much just like cotton, and that's fine. It's like super rare. It's the same thing as wine and incense. I think it's fine. I think it's great. As far as all the faith pantheons go, I think it's like the faith from forest tiles. This is just a nerfed version of desert folklore, but harder to use because it's like a one food, one production tile.
And
now,
you can't chop or you lose the benefit.
Unless you're right, you have you get one food, three hammers, one faith.
But not until medieval. You're not going to be able to work that as Iroquois until medieval when you have the workshops, because the Iroquois bonuses come from workshop, not from their Sith.
I cannot consider going Nature's Blessing ever unless I have a lot of deer with forests or other resources that have forests on them, because I cannot be working one food, one hammer for fucking faith. That's ridiculous.
Yeah.
As far as spirit animal goes, I think in rare circumstances could it be quite strong, but it's never going to be stronger than desert folklore, so how do you nerf desert folklore without just removing it? So everything in comparison to desert folklore seems rather lackluster. As far as stuff like God of Craftsmen, I think that's good. There's another one I wanted to say. Where is it?
God of War, what do you think of it? One.
What do I think of what?
Way Shrines.
Way Shrines is absolute shit. Like, you have to build a fucking road. You have to build a road, so you have to not improve other tiles. That is the most detrimental pantheon in existence. It's the worst I've ever seen. I will never pick this up ever.
Does it offend shrines, you that it's in the game?
at least the gods of messengers or whatever, giving you two science, it was somewhat cool, especially for Liberty, but it was mainly a thing I'd go with Maya, where I'd dump cities everywhere.
But hold on. I want to address that real quick, because that's what you just said is Maya is basically why that matters for Maya is because Maya has its own faith generation built into it with their pyramids, right? So what he basically said is that's a cool bonus that applies when you already have your faith taken care of, hint piety. And so you could do cool pantheons that have bonuses that are production or science or growth that don't get you religion with piety. See where we're going with this, Fruitstrike?
Right.
Talk about that with you after people are done. I don't want to interrupt someone.
Go on. What do you think of God of War?
I was just about to say that. I think for his mid game, it starts to get ridiculous, like you're saying, Filthy. Early game, you kind of have like this workboat faith production sort of duel, which barely gets you. I wouldn't say barely. It depends on how many barb camps you're farming, but it's a pretty strong faith generator if you're farming enough barb camps near cities that you have. So it's really good. It's towards the later starts parts of the game where it gets crazy. I'm killing an infantry and I'm getting 70 faith from that. Holy shit. I just gained like a churn of gameplay, you know, as far as faith goes.
Okay.
That said, I do like the concept. And I've had a lot of fun with it, but I think it's a bit strong.
Okay, cool.
But not so strong in the early.
Everything?
Are you trying to get out of here first, Strike?
No. Yes, but no.
I'll say one more thing. As far as the faith from like dyes and faith from plantations, just like the two culture pantheons, those are really only things that you're going to be going when you are opening up piety or you're Maya or Ethiopia, especially when you're Maya or Ethiopia, because you can actually get a religion with these and they can boost your social policies into picking up more stuff into piety, because piety has a severe issue with culture, and it allows, or just picking up that pantheon can allow you to open up piety, get this culture pantheon, and go into Liberty or something. And I've done most of my games as Liberty Piety.
Okay.
Can I just say one thing?
Yeah, I was just going to open it up to anyone who wants to talk.
Don't do that.
Would there be a way of removing desert folklore from floodplains? Because I feel you should have to sacrifice your growth if you really want to push for desert religion from desert folklore. The way it is at the moment, it's just so overpowered. It's unreal. Because you can grow and still work the faith tiles.
Yeah, it definitely needs a nerf, desert folklore, for sure.
I'm still opting for just more religion, so everybody can get a use of those pantheons.
All right, the last thing I wanted to do is general things here.
I did want to say something about finished. God of War.
Okay, go ahead, Zemt.
I think the entire problem spawning from God of War is the ability to farm barb camps. I don't like
that's
that
really
mechanic.
Way to get a religion.
I understand that, but the idea of farming barb camps to me is it feels like exploiting the game. I don't like that mechanic whatsoever.
Honor kind of has to do that right now. It has no early game if you don't do that.
Right, I know.
I don't mind
like
it doing that though.
Somehow.
You can without counter people farming barb camps. You're
making a tradition or Liberty clone. You there's no other way without drastically changing honor.
Yep.
And all it takes is just a couple of units to just go fuck with their barb camp. If you cannot farm 3 barb camps, you're useless as honor.
Yep, and also if you attack someone who's playing honor, who's farming barb camps, they have to bring all their military units back to defend. They can't farm the barb camp anymore. So like, as soon as they go to war, they lose all of the culture, gold, and faith that they're getting from that.
From barb camps, but then they get it from killing units.
Yeah, but we're still getting to the point, we're focusing on war.
Yeah.
Sure, but it's a war game.
Wait, is
no,
focusing on
this
war
is
bad
civilization.
For this game?
No, focusing on war is good for the game.
Yeah, it's good, but I think we're getting a little bit ahead of ourselves, and just everything right now focuses totally on war. Totally on war.
Well, everything doesn't focus on war. Everyone's using the things that are made to accelerate their war game. That's how players are playing it.
No, I mean, it's not to belittle people saying that, but ultimately it doesn't matter what you do. If I can kill you, it doesn't matter what you do. So it's ultimately a war game, right? Like, you want to go to space? Fine. You got to defend from me killing you if you want to go to space. You want to do fucking tourism? Fine. You got to defend from me killing you. You want to farm fucking 15 camps? You got to defend your cities while you're doing that. Prevent me from killing you. It's a war
game.
That's
what I'm trying to say, basically, that with all those changes right now, the focus turns even more into war, because focusing on other parts of the game like science or economy or culture or whatever does not help you to defend in the end.
The game has always been a war game. Even before the mod, I've never been able to do... Whenever I play games, I'm always thinking, how can I kill my opponents? How can I eliminate them? Like, even if I'm doing science.
Yeah, of course.
And honestly...
Everybody's thinking about that. I absolutely agree with that. That, like, war is a huge part of this game. But what I'm trying to say is that all the changes right now to benefit war only, and even if the other changes benefit indirectly, basically the options to... I like the idea of getting
type,
more,
right?
The idea from Filthy that he said, like, get indirect support for science by reducing hammers required to crank out buildings, required to increase science. I like that route, because if you make choices, you're trying to attempt science victory, you free up a little bit of hammers to actually be able to defend, even if you're going for science victory. This is what I'm trying to say. All the changes right now are not looking at the other parts of the game. Okay, I want to go tradition rationalism, but I'm fucked up if somebody wants to kill me before my science is going to kick in, because I need to spend hammers and social policies on things that does not help me to defend. Does not
the American mentality, Victor. What a stupid comment.
That's just my opinion.
Reiterate again right now, all of the changes have been focused on domination, Vic, and the reason why is because can't really have to do all of them at the same time. So I agree with you. Yes, most of the changes are done for war right now, and the reason why that was picked as the first one is because that is the most entertaining generally to play and to watch. I do want all 4 victory paths to be viable at some point. That is definitely the goal, but it's not there yet for sure.
Sure, and those policies need to be viable via interaction, though. It still needs player interaction. The problem with the previous game, the problem with the base game, which is why I like this mod, yes, it encourages war, but it encourages war because the previous game actually encouraged no interaction with your opponents. It encouraged you sitting back. The further away from your opponents, the better. The more science buildings, the better. Doing a very set tech path and going to fucking space. That was the encouragement. Or going to stealth bombers or going to nuclear bombs. Whatever the science victory was, we can call it a science victory or domination victory, is exactly the same thing in the late game. So I like the changes that encourage interaction.
I suppose you could add parts to rationalism to give cities better strength and bonuses for fighting in your own territory, because then you're not only gaining science, you're gaining benefits to defend yourself while
that's
going
interesting.
Down that science route.
Yeah, I was thinking about like 20% defense minus 20% offense. Like you're, so even if you get the higher techs, it's that you're not as good
minus.
Outside.
I don't either, but you got to be careful with stacking bonuses. Himeje plus Shoshone plus Great Wall is plus Defender of the Faith is already insane. Don't add a fourth. Don't add a fourth bonus. You mean like tanks? You're thinking like tanks are 100% bonus. They're fucking sitting on 100% bonus basically already. Like don't add another. All right. So
Okay.
Next stage.
Wanted to talk about any of that stuff.
Last stage then.
I'm gonna hard cap this. This is a hard cap. 16 minutes left at 5 p.m. I'm shutting it off.
All right, so there's Yoruus, myself, Arvius, and Baba's not here, so it's 3 minutes each. So it's 16 minutes, call it 15, call it 5 each, right? Yeah? Okay, yeah, Yoruus, you start. 5 minutes, go. Anything. You can talk about anything here.
Okay, overall. Well, first of all, still, I'm going to remind for the like fifth time in here, I like to get religions war going. I would like to free up that everybody can get a religion. This way, all the pantheons are useful. I would like to add more enhancer, founder, and more beliefs to the religion. Maybe not like everything is super strong, but to support other victory paths. So yeah, the person who gets first religion gets the most boost, but so the other guys at least can have, I don't know, second guy 75% of the good stuff the first guy gets, third guy 50%, and like the rest 50% of the best stuff. Maybe focused a little bit on different science victories. Maybe, well, that's a lot of stuff to talk and think, so, but just free up 6 religions in a 6-player game, add more reformation beliefs, maybe even you can add double reformation beliefs. If 2 people go actually piety, they can use a useful reformation belief and not be fucked up if they go piety for reformation belief, because they can't choose like buying great person or buying buildings. So this is the first thing. I said, for now, the changes are focusing the war only, and I have a strong problem with honor that gets rolling, especially with God of War. I don't like it too much. Well, though I do like the change because the interactions are really, really cool, and people need to learn how to counter stuff, like, let's say, even barb camping, barb farming, or getting like city states with patronage and stuff that people need to learn. They need to be more active in countering all those strategies, something that people just need to learn while they will play the game, and it will take some time to get used to. But I also would like to boost up other victory types, especially tourism, tourism and science victory. I would like to do it indirectly. Now, the problem with tourism is because of the culture over all the trees right now, tourists just can't keep up. And with the changes to great scientists, you can't effectively bulb into national visitor center or internet or any of the stuff that actually boosts your culture tremendously. I like the changes and proposition from Filthy to changes to rationalize to make it indirectly boost science victory route, either by just reducing the hammers required to get science buildings or help to defend or do other kind of stuff in that. And I do not like the, like for the ending of this, I do not like the general movement in honor. I feel it's tremendously overpowered. If you do make changes to any social policies or any mechanics in the game, you gotta still think about having an option to counter something. Making a change that does not allow you to counter anything, but whatever you can do, you can't counter something. And like change the great general that removes 4 tiles, you can't counter that. It's impossible. Okay, I'm done.
Thanks, Yoruus. Okay, you wanna go, Filthy?
No, go ahead, Arvius.
Alright, let's see, as far as religion goes, maybe 5. I can't justify 6, I think. In my mind, I don't see why there should be 6 religions. I do agree with a lot of, do realize it's a beta. I mean, yeah, there should be some more focus towards like making the victory paths better. And I've said this many times, more and better reformations. I think there shouldn't be so many garbage beliefs as far as actual religion beliefs, not reformation beliefs, just actual beliefs. I think some should be buffed. I think there should be some that are significantly, if not twice as strong as others. So there's a first come, first serve sort of deal with that. As far as like generals and the movements from that for honor, I completely disagree with that, because what the fuck do I do when I see someone with first move on me? Like, oh my god, how many times have you guys lost a general because you move into like a hill tile? And it's like, oh, I didn't get first move and my entire war is just ruined. Just ruined. So honor helps with that. It helps for you to actually have potential in war. Is the problem with generating too many generals, is that necessarily something that you think is a problem, Yoruus, or why is the movement such a bad thing? And you actually can counter this, because you can spam fort tiles. If you have units on forts, I cannot remove those. I have to pretty much general your fort tiles to actually
I'm gonna answer that question. Well, we talked about it earlier on, but basically in honor, if the extra experience generated from units does not go into the great generals, then I like the finisher. But if you already get the great 50% boost in experience and it goes towards great generals, then the finisher is out of the point. What I'm trying to say about the great generals, imagine, okay, early war, great wall, maybe problems like walls and stuff, but imagine late game.
Late game generals don't matter.
With great generals, I would say, like, okay, if we have a problem about the
Hold
fast clicks,
my ears just cut out. I'd like change the battery.
Keep going, okay. Yours. He can hear you. Keep going.
All right. Basically, what I don't like about the honor is, as I said, something to counter. You can't counter 4 movement generals if you don't go honor yourself. So if you're facing, let's imagine, guy with great wall goes honor right now, and he's got 4 movement generals, and you're trying to defend with your generals. Now you're fucked. You're totally fucked. You can't do anything. Even you've got fast clicks, you can't do anything. Now, I would like, if we have a problem, if this changes like for problem with fast clicks or anything like that, just add, I don't know, 1 movement then. Let's add 1 movement to great generals to everybody. And if you add 1 movement to great generals to everybody, then we're cool, and then honor can get 4 movement great generals. But if you keep 4 movement great generals for honor, then add 3 movement great generals for everybody else. So I'm not forced into going honor just because I want to defend myself. That's all that my
problem. I'm not understanding.
Guys, also cut out. Let me just quickly interrupt here again. Not a debate, right? We don't need to convince each other. We're presenting each of our opinions here. Yoruus has presented his opinion, and now Arvius, you present your opinion, and then we'll move on.
Yeah, 9 minutes, because I got to pee, too.
My headset did turn off, like, halfway through at least partially through what you were saying, but I think you can defend, and I, like, especially if you have Great Wall, you can defend against the generals.
I totally get it.
Let's make it basically like cut it down. 4 movement generals for honor, 3 movement generals for everybody else. We deal with the problem with fast clicks, and everybody has a fair chance. With honor having advantage. That's my opinion on the subject.
I still wasn't quite seeing the issues there, but as far as my opinion goes, I think it's all right where it's at. And there's not much else I really have to say at the moment for other things.
Okay.
Okie dokie.
I'll go. Can you hold it for 3 more minutes, you're saying?
Yeah, the clock's ticking, buddy.
All right. So I don't want 6 religions. Religions are a limited resource. They ought to be competed over. Poland and Korea need a nerf. They're too strong. With the increase in social policies has made Poland too strong. And the increase in the buff to... great people in general has made Korea too strong. It's too easy to work specialist slots with no downside to Korea. Pantheons, I did have a thought. This is throwing this out there. I'm not highly decided either way on this. I kind of like the idea of the Pantheon being permanent for the capital, regardless of if they get taken over by another religion. Bonus generals, two things. I think the honor generation to generals is too much, too many generals. That's one. Two, I think the number of generals you actually get should be based on the number of players you're fighting. So you should have a bonus to general production if you're fighting multiple players, because you're fighting multiple people spawning generals and it's too strong.
Can you say that one more time, that last point that you made?
Sure. When you're fighting multiple players, you know how Sweden has a bonus to great person generation based on the number of friendships it has? I think people in general should have a bonus to their great general production based on the number of players they're at war with. I don't know quite how that'd be implemented, but that's the thought. Fucking two people, they have twice as much general production as I do. I think foreign legions are currently too strong. They're the only military unit that can be granted from ideology, and they're extraordinarily strong. If a tech leader goes freedom and foreign legion cannon rushes you, or foreign legion arty rushes you, you can't stop it with equivalent unit tech. It's impossible to stop it. They're too strong. I think that should be moved into the later eras of freedom, maybe a finishing policy. I don't really care what it gives this finishing policy, but foreign legions is fine as it is. I think the unit cap in general should be removed. I think it's terrible for the game. There's no reason that I should have a unit cap based on my one city. I already have a ton of penalties associated with one city. I think Mausoleum of Halicarnassus is currently too strong. The buffs to great people have not been adjusted for a mausoleum. It needs to be nerfed slightly. I've never got to tanks yet. I don't know if this is a problem with the current war situation, but as it is, my games always end in the artillery era at the moment. I think honor in the late game is too strong. Same with God of War. I think basically science, gold, and science, gold, culture, and faith from honor in the late game scales disproportionately in the final eras of the game relative to the previous eras of the game. I don't know if that should be a nerf to those entirely or just a nerf in the later eras, but maybe something needs to be slowed down for that. I think faith purchasing military units needs to be buffed as a whole. It's too weak. It should not go down. You shouldn't lose the proportion of faith you already have to pay for military units is really, really, really high. I don't think it should go down each era. The efficiency of faith purchasing goes down era by era, which is no good.
I agree on that. Forgot about that.
I think Great Wall should be a localized effect, not an empire-wide effect. So if you build a Great Wall in a city, that city's borders should have Great Wall, but no other borders in your empire should. I don't know if that's technically possible, but it would allow for strategic placement of Great Wall without it being everywhere. I like four-movement honors, four-movement general honor for four-movement generals. I think it lets you counter first move and lets you counter Great Wall, which are currently game-breaking. If you attack into someone who has first move, it's almost impossible to general onto certain tiles. Just because that you move the general up, they shoot you in the first turn, and then they go first and shoot you on the second turn. Then none of your units can possibly survive punishment for two turns in a row without losing a general. And if you lose a general or two, the game is over. I think overall honor generation is a little bit too high. But that can be tuned down. In general, I just want to say, Fruity, I know we're talking, this is a lot of critical stuff for your stuff, man, but this is a fucking phenomenal mod. It makes the game so much better. So this is a beta. We're talking about balance changes, but just overall, this is awesome. So please, anyways, that's me done. So cheers.
Thank you. That was very nice. Okay. Hold on. Let me look in chat. Okay, the bladder timer hasn't expired, so if anybody else in chat wants to say anything, we've got like 3 minutes.
I would like a minute if possible.
Sure.
Okay, so if you want honor and higher profile openers, I think they need some sort of SimCity buff to what they're currently at. I don't think honor is a viable opener by itself. It needs like a complement of liberty or tradition still, so it needs like I'm not sure what it is. I'm just throwing it out there. It needs some sort of SimCity buff. Same with piety, and I think we've gotten a lot of important things out of the way, like using pantheons with SimCity or having some sort of reformation relief be SimCity buff. I think that needs to be implemented. That's like the main thing I want, and also maybe my idea of being able to buy settlers or workers will also be with faith. Would also be a nice boost to the SimCity.
Well, okay. You can like get a culture ruin and open up tradition. Is that the problem that you're seeing right now, Zemp? Because that's quite Like it's quite common to do that because you can't really realistically farm barbs with your one warrior and your one fucking scout, so you can't really get the additional policies in honor. But it's actually a viable opener.
I don't think you can just go 5 honor and be competitive.
I can and have, and I did it with 6 strong players.
I just wanted to add one thing about what Filthy said about the belief when you can buy pre-industrial units with Fate and you can buy later on the industrial, well, past industrial era units. I don't know if it's possible, like cap it 2 Fate, 1 Hammer in every single era, because right now pre-industrial is useful until you not reach Renaissance era, or well, in the Renaissance era, not actually in the medieval era. It's useful only in medieval era when you've got 2 Fate per 1 Hammer on a unit, and in the later eras it's useless, and like buying post-industrial era units, it's absolutely useless because it goes like 8 Fate for 1 Hammer and the units cost so much you're never going to use it.
Okay, I can do that.
Can I? 1 minute?
No, 30 seconds, because I hard capped it at 5, and I owe it to my boyfriend to get off of this now, and like, that was the wrong word to use, but you know, whatever. 30 seconds, go ahead.
Yeah, the only thing I was going to add is just, this is more of a question for you, like, roadmap-wise, there's so many things to fix in the mod and just in this game in general. Is there kind of an idea, like, the next version is going to be tackling this one specific thing? Like, are you going to tackle civs, or religions, or more policies, like, what's your kind of roadmap for handling all this?
Yeah, so I've generally been putting what's in the change list for the next version as I go. Currently, what I'm thinking for the next version is whatever needs to be done to exploration, reformation beliefs. There's going to be a lot of work that goes into translating the game into Polish, German, and Russian for the people who play it in those languages. And hopefully, I'm still looking into the Mac, trying to get it to work on the Mac. Mostly, I just want to get it to more people. I think the next version is going to be a little bit lighter on changes. It's going to be more tweaks instead of lots of new stuff. And then after that, like a hard look at ideologies and victory conditions. Maybe World Congress, maybe spies. I don't know. I mean, like, it's all about what people want to see worked on, I guess.
The only thing I would suggest is just to try to maybe handle things also that deal with the early game first, because those are things that we test every day compared to like long-term stuff. So like even looking at civs, like you said, Korean, Poland, like those kind of things would be good to do early.
If you say Shoshone, we're going to stop this thing right now. Something.
What?
Well, I gotta
Shoshone fucking sucks.
I got to say one thing though. Now, with all those changes, we're implementing stuff that needs to other players to be proactive to stop that from happening, for example, honor or even piety or other stuff. Now, I see Poland or overpowered ships like Babylon, Korea, is the same goddamn thing. Those neighbors of those ships just needs to be proactive. Goddamn it, your neighbor with Babylon, just use those damn two neighbors to kill the goddamn guy before he gets out of hand. So I not necessarily like to go that crazy into changing the Civ's unique abilities and unique buildings, because eventually we're gonna just take the spirit out of Civ at some point. That's my personal opinion.
Really hard to kill Babylon, but yeah.
I'm not even touch that. Fruitstrike, we've reached the limit. Cheers, man. I really appreciate you doing this today. This is good stuff.
Sure. Thank you guys for all taking the time.
Yeah, thanks, Fruitstrike. Good luck, man.
And don't forget to download Hellblazer's map script, because it's
really
awesome.
God. It makes the game so much better. Although, Hellblazer, we got to talk at some point about the actual distances from other players. I don't know if the map is just drawing us together closely or not, but it's been crazy close. So.
Okay. I'm in. Jet, I'm gonna go
later for a second
to the bathroom and then hang out with the man.
All right, have fun, man.
Okay,
catch
you
later
for a
second.
Right.
User disconnected from your channel.
Right, yours.
Oh, what?
Sorry, I was just gonna say.
Host, you want to say something?
Yeah, I just want to say thanks, man. I know it's late for you. I appreciate you coming up for this and talking about the stuff. I really appreciate it. So, cheers.
I wish I was there for those policies. Sorry, guys.
5 hours to sleep before work.
Good night, guys. I'm gonna disappear off TeamSpeak. I'll see you all in the stream.
Do you see what I said, Filthy, or no?
Just as a quick.
I messaged you something in Steam.
Go on, DMR. Go on,
Yeah, just as a quick note, if you can, if you put it on low seas now, you'll get much bigger land, and the series will be more spread out.